गुड मॉर्निंग कन्नन जी,
लाइव
मॉर्निंग
क्रिस्प एंड क्लियर कन्नन।
हाय कन्नन, मॉर्निंग
मॉर्निंग मॉर्निंग कृष्णन,
मॉर्निंग
मॉर्निंग कन्नन,
मॉर्निंग कन्नन।
कटिंग इट इन द निक ऑफ टाइम, सॉरी,
हैंडलिंग टू मेनी,
नो नो, मोर देन मीटिंग सम क्लिनिकल कमिटमेंट्स, सो व्हिच वेयर ड्यू यस्टरडे एंड टुडे. Otherwise, we were catching flies. So suddenly, yesterday and today, we had to do something.
If you are going to say you are catching flies in your hospital, it shows your hospital is not clean enough.
Hospital is doing well. I am catching flies. Hospital is doing well. In spite of me, it is doing fine.
Okay.
That's being too modest, Kanan.
Kanan's modesty personifies.
Yeah, that's being too modest.
Reality, but though sometimes it's becoming like that.
Yeah, I think everybody is in now. Mm.
Yes.
Hi Kannan.
Hi. Yeah. Just once. So, Jimson, when you are,
yes Kannan,
when you are inaugurating, do you want to tell everyone? Just keep your videos off and microphone. Sorry, they will be muted. Whoever is joining in the middle won't be muted. So
yeah, I will.
So sir, by default, everyone is on mute.
As a reminder, if they log out,
they cannot enable.
Okay, then it's fine. Yeah. Oh yeah. Okay. The previously what I found is if you are continuously there, you can't enable, but if I log out and then log in again, or somebody is joining in the middle after 20 minutes there.
So nobody can enable. Only panelist can do it.
This thing is we are not controlling. I'm just turning because suddenly in the sunlight I look brighter.
Mayank, what is HCPs only? Healthcare professional.
Healthcare professional.
Oh, this is your disclaimer.
I think you should add like how AO says. Mere attending this webinar does not make you a qualified orbit researcher.
I think we can start at 11 o'clock, madam.
Yeah. Savita?
Yep.
So good morning, one and all. It is my privilege on behalf of the Association of Oral and Maxillofacial Surgeons, Tamil Nadu and Pondicherry chapter, along with the Craniofacial Academy of Stryker, to invite or to welcome each one of you to this second session of the trauma webinar series of the month of June. I welcome each one of you to this fantastic session that is going to be hosted by the Association of Oral and Maxillofacial Surgeons, Tamil Nadu Pondicherry chapter. Welcome one and all.
Thank you, ma'am, for the introduction. Thank you everyone for joining in. It's our pleasure to have two fantastic speakers and two experienced moderators. Now it's my pleasure to introduce the moderators, Dr. Vivek Narayanan and Dr. Kannan Balaraman. Both of them does not require any introduction. But as a protocol, I would like to introduce both of them first. Dr. Vivek Narayanan did his BDS and MDS from Annamalai University way back in the year 1988. And then he completed his MDS in 1997. After his completion, he started his teaching career at Meenakshi Ammal Dental College, where he worked for a very long time. And then he is the dean and head of the department of oral maxillofacial surgery at SRM Dental College, Kattangottu. And he was also a recipient of the best teacher award awarded by the government of Tamil Nadu by the governor in 2012. Welcome, Dr. Vivek Narayanan, to the program. And next moderator we have is Dr. Kannan Balraman. Again, he is no stranger to us in the field of oral maxillofacial surgery and AMSI. He again completed his MDS from the prestigious Annamalai University, and he went on to work for a few years in the UK, and then came back to India to continue his work in amongst us. And right now he is the chief consultant oral maxillofacial surgeon at Ganga Hospital, Coimbatore. Welcome, Kannan, to the show. Over to you, moderators.
Good morning, all. I take it a privilege to introduce the speakers for the day. Dr. Krishnan, a maxillofacial surgeon, currently is the additional professor, Department of Dentistry at JIPMER Pondicherry. He is qualified dually at UK, and he's got an experience of over 18 years. He's got numerous publications, and I'm sure he would enlighten the audience with his experience. It's also my privilege to introduce the next speaker, a good friend and colleague, Dr. Anant Narayan, who needs not much of introduction, but he did his master's from AB Shetty. He's trained in fellowship of cleft and craniofacial surgery. He's a DIPNB holder, and he has completed his fellowship and member from Edinburgh and Ireland. He's also an examiner to the Royal College of Surgeons. His specialty or repertoire includes craniofacial deformities, TMJ surgery, and orbital surgery. He's an invited speaker in various forums, got a lot of publications, contributed to various textbooks. He's currently the professor at Meenakshi Ammal Dental College, and he's a consultant at Shankar Netralaya and Arvind Hai Hospitals. Thank you very much for this opportunity. Over to the speakers. I think we will start with Dr. Krishnan.
I'll have to ask Dr. Jimson. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Is it visible, please?
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah. Very good morning to all of you, and good afternoon to some people. Welcome to all my colleagues who have logged into this webinar on decision making and best practices in orbital fractures conducted by the AOMSI, Tamil Nadu Pondicherry, and the Craniofacial Academy of Stryker. I'm not really sure whether I am qualified enough to speak on this topic, because my experience with orbital surgeries has been only in the past 3 to 4 years, and I feel I have a considerable distance to cover before I can say that I am a decent orbital surgeon myself. But anyway, thank you all for this opportunity. So if I was asked a few days before how I would want to spend my Sunday morning or afternoon, my choices would be cook up a meal, binge watch a series on my favorite streaming service, or sometimes even catch a quick snooze after a quick breakfast. You know, attending an academic webinar would definitely not be on my list, and I'm sure that that would be the situation for most of the participants who have logged in. I'm sure that we are all aware of the COVID pandemic that is running through the entire world. Another pandemic that is facing us daily is this webinar pandemic. Everywhere you turn around and see, you have webinars conducted by someone or other. So despite this webinar pandemic and webinar fatigue, if you people have decided to log in on this Sunday morning and spend your time in some academic pursuit, I think I would like to start off with a firm salute to all of you. Yeah, so the eyes have always been associated very closely with literature, beauty, mythology, and even religion. But the external beauty of the eye is largely dependent upon its internal supporting structure, which is hidden, namely the orbit and the supporting ligaments. Now, like all bones, orbits can also fracture. They can be in isolation or in combination with other facial injuries. An improper treatment of these fractures can have consequences on vision, function, and aesthetics. Now, a good surgeon is one who makes his clinical decision based on available scientific literature and one's clinical experience. So this webinar is patterned on some of the clinical decisions that a maxillofacial surgeon would have to take when he or she is treating a patient with an orbiting fracture. So how do fractures of the orbit occur? The accepted theories generally are that when there is a blunt blow to the orbit, resulting in a rapid occlusion of the orbit aperture, there is a compression of the inferior orbital ring, which results to a buckling and fracture of the orbital floor. Others also say that the fracture of the weak posterior medial portion of the orbital floor is mainly as a protective mechanism to compensate for the sudden increase in this orbital pressure that occurs. Now, the fractures of the orbit, we all know, can be classified as pure and impure. A pure orbital floor fracture is one in which the outer orbital frame is intact, whereas impure fractures are those that are associated with disruption of one or more walls of the orbit. So my first question that I would want to ask myself when I see a patient is, does my patient have an orbital fracture? Now, looks can be deceiving. For example, a patient with periorbital ecchymosis, periorbital edema, subconjunctival ectomyosis, anesthesia of the infraorbital nerve may not have a fracture of the orbit at all. Conversely, a young child like this who has no overt signs of an ocular trauma may actually have a hidden fracture that requires an emergency treatment. So how do you go about examining the eye in your clinic? The basic minimum would be to try to assess if the patient is able to have a proper vision and the response of the pupils to light. Remember, while assessing vision, to check whether the patient was wearing glasses. And I myself have made this mistake a few times without realizing that the diminished vision was because the patient had no longer his glasses. The patient should also be able to perform a full range of ocular movements without any complaint of double vision. And while examining for a possible anophthalmos through a worm's eye view, please remember that the developing edema and hematoma may actually give an illusion of proptosis hiding the true anophthalmos. So if your basic ophthal evaluation was perfectly fine, do you still have to go in for a formal ophthalmology review? Now, in almost all cases of the midface, where the fractures of the midface, where the orbit is involved, an ophthalmic consultation is mandated. What would the ophthalmologist do? The ophthalmologist would, through a slit lamp examination, confirm the absence of any intraocular injury, check the visual acuity, reassess the patient's ability to perform ocular movements and whether there's any diplopia. If there is diplopia, try to determine whether this is because of a muscle entrapment or a nerve palsy by a force reduction test. And finally, assess the lacrimal drainage apparatus.
Krishna,
the ophthalmologist would also hear.
Krishna, just to say, there is a comment saying there is the voice is not audible. People have just logged in. So if you can just increase the volume of your listing or minimize the echo, whatever.
Yeah.
Thank you. Sorry.
dialing.
You don't have to log out, but
am
just.
Am I audible now?
Yeah, yeah, clear. Just goes.
Could you please check with the audience whether I'm audible now? Could somebody just give a comment, please?
I think now it's better. The echoing is lesser. Continue. If there's anything, I will get back. So no problem.
Yeah, it is fine. They have replied. Yeah.
Yeah. So the ophthalmologist would also give you an assessment of the anterior posterior positioning of the globes in comparison to each other. Now, why is this all important? This is important not only for a medical legal reason, but it also gives you an ability to objectively assess the clinical outcomes of this patient. Diplopia charting is often confusing for most maxillofacial surgeons. Looks Greek and Latin. Very simple understanding is needed. For example, if you notice, compare these two diplopia charts, the area covered by the left eye is much lesser than the area covered by the right. This means that there is restricted ocular motility on the left eye. The other thing to observe is there will be certain red spots in the diplopia chart, which I have marked out through a green circle. This determines the central position, determines the primary gaze, and this determines the mid and the far periphery. Now, it is obvious in this case that there is a disruption and there is not a matching of position in the primary gaze as well as the mid and the far periphery. The lines are not matching. Similarly, in the lower picture, you can find that the mediolateral dimension of this eye in another patient is much lower, much smaller than that of the opposite eye. So basically, this is the information in the upper picture that the patient is not capable of upward and downward movement or is having a restriction in upward and downward movement. And in this situation, the picture below, the patient is having restriction in the medial and lateral direction. So now that you have done your basic ophthalmic evaluation, the next question is, what is the imaging that should ask for? Now, I know that most textbooks say that trauma screening should start off with some basic x-rays. The most common would be occipital mentone view. Textbooks describe the presence of a tear duct sign that is indicative of an orbital infection. The problem with plain x-rays is that it does not give any information to the surgeon about the extent of fracture and any information about the surrounding soft tissues. At best, a screening x-ray, a plain x-ray can be used as a screening tool to just rule out any intraorbital metallic foreign objects. The gold standard is CT scans. You should ask the radiologist to give you fine cut CT scans of the orbit, 0.6 or 1 mm cuts. You would be paying special attention to any disruptions in the sphenozygomatic suture, disruptions at the medial wall and the orbital floor, okay, and also look for unusual positions of the muscle. Comparison of bone and soft tissue windows is very helpful in a better assessment of the extraocular musculature and the soft tissue. I would advise you to pay particular attention to the shape of the extraocular muscle. A rounding of the inferior rectus muscle compared to its normal elliptical shape is a definitive indication of a possible entrapment. Similarly, also pay close attention to this junction of the medial wall and the floor of the orbit, what is known as the angle of the inferomedial strut or the AAOS, which gives you information whether the patient is having fracture in the medial wall and in the orbit. So pay particularly close attention to the muscle shape and the AIOS. All of us have a fascination for three-dimensional reconstruction. They give a fair overview for the surgeon to make a basic surgical plan. But in orbital fractures, please be aware that the thin orbital floor and the medial wall, even if normal, may be misrepresented in a 3D reconstruction as a possible factor leading to a misdiagnosis. So pay particular attention to the 2D scan rather than the 3D scan. The CT scans would also help you in quick identification of possible ocular injuries, such as a retrobulbar hemorrhage. You can see a punctured globe out here and a dislocated lens. people might wonder, does MRI have a role in orbital imaging? In the acute trauma situation, it's my opinion that MRI hardly has any role for practical logistic reasons, that it takes quite some time to get MRI images. Also, most of the information the surgeon usually wants for planning the surgery or and deciding the exact pathology is already available with a CT scan. Now, I would pay attention to this picture out here, A and B. I picked it up from the Journal of Craniofacial Surgery, where the ophthalmologist has described a condition where a patient came with a trivial injury to the side of the face, was evaluated by the maxillofacial surgeon, and because the patient showed no overt signs of any fracture, was discharged from the OPD. The patient came back quite a number of days later with a complaint of severe pain in the eye and a restriction in ocular mobility. When the ophthalmologist took a CT scan, they were quite surprised to find a deep located metallic foreign object. Now imagine what would have happened if this patient had been taken up for an MRI. The consequences would have been disastrous. Despite this imaging modalities, there will be situations where you cannot get the entire information by the imaging, and you would understand the complexity of the fracture only when you surgically expose. So once your imaging and your clinical examination is complete, the next question that we are all concerned with is, does my patient need surgery or not? And if the patient needs surgery, do I have to do it immediately or can I wait and watch? Now the answers to these questions depends upon what is described as the personality of the fracture. Factors such as the age of the patient, the severity of the fracture, the functional impairments, the aesthetic deformities, all those would determine in your decision making. While we are vexing ourselves whether we should operate or not operate, often our best plans, cold water is put on it by an anesthetist who says that sorry, the patient is not fit for surgery. So this is something that we all experience in our surgical career. Keep good relations with the anesthetist. So when should we consider intervention? Now let us consider a situation in which there is a vision loss following the orbital trauma. There is no globe injury, and this is described as a traumatic optic neuropathy. Now most of us would logically come to the conclusion that if a patient has had a vision loss, then definitely this requires an intervention. Not necessarily so. Unless there is a CT evidence that shows an obvious impingement of the optic nerve by a bony spicule, that does not seem to be any realistic indication for a surgical intervention at this time. Most of the times, these bony impingements are removed by endoscopic access. And further, if you try to do an orbital reconstruction in a patient with a traumatic optic neuropathy, you may actually worsen the prognosis. In most conditions, a traumatic optic neuropathy is usually managed by the ophthalmologist by pharmacological measures. Even if you have a sudden loss of vision with retrobulbar hemorrhage, the surgical intervention is probably limited to performing a lateral canthotomy and cantalysis or disruption of the orbital septum. I understand that in ophthalmic literature, they even consider a wait and watch protocol and do not jump into an immediate canthotomy and cantalysis as we usually think. Another indication for an emergency management would be a very unusual and uncommon condition, which is the traumatic dislocation of the eyeball into the maxillary. So this was an unusual case report where I saw that there is this gentleman with severe periorbital edema, but when the eyelids were retracted, there was absence of globe, and the CT scan showed that the globe had herniated into the maxillary. So probably in this condition, an emergency intervention is indicated because any delay would definitely result in an irretrievable loss of vision. The next condition would be, should I intervene if a patient is having restricted ocular motility and diplopia? Now, it's important to understand why there is diplopia and restricted offline mobility in orbital fractures. Now, unlike what we think that is the most common cause, which is the direct entrapment of the extraocular musculature, literature says that this restricted ocular motility is more as a result of herniation of the periorbital sac and the connective tissue into the sinuses. And these herniations exert a traction on the adjacent musculature by septal interconnection. This results in an imbalance of muscular movement, resulting in diplopia. Also remember that restricted ocular motility can be also because of muscular damage and neuronal damage to that extraocular muscle. This differentiation can be done only by a post-duction test. A person who has got a restricted ocular motility because of neuronal damage, you will be able to move the eyeballs, globes easily in all directions in comparison to that of a person entrapped. So, let us suppose that your patient is having a positive post-duction test, which means that there is a muscle entrapment. Does this mean that you have to go in and intervene immediately? Not necessarily. In most situations, it would be prudent to wait for about 7 to 10 days to allow for the edema and the hemorrhage to subside. In many individuals, you would find that there is a significant improvement in the ocular motility and diplopia after the 7 to 10 days, and the surgical intervention may not be actually essential. Also remember that if after 7 to 10 days, your post-duction test is still positive, it means that there is a definite muscle incarceration and you have to intervene quickly before muscle fibrosis sets. Now I keep talking about diplopia. So the next question that I would ask is, do all diplopia need intervention? So diplopia is a very disconcerting complication for the patient. But diplopia in all cases is not equally disconcerting. It has been found that diplopia on downward gaze is the one that causes maximum interference with the patient's daily function. Of course, if you happen to be, if your patient happens to have a profession like an electrician or a painter or say an astronomer who would have to look up, then diplopia on upward gaze would be quite difficult for day-to-day functioning. So what diplopia requires intervention? A restriction in an upward and downward gaze within 30 degree of primary position with the positive force reduction test 7 to 10 days after injury and the definite radiological confirmation of a fracture of the orbital floor would mean that the patient needs intervention. So a wait and watch policy seems to be prudent in most cases. However, there may be one particular instance where it is important to intervene immediately. This is the classical trapdoor fracture or the whiteout fracture, white-eye blowout fracture that we all are quite conversant with, in which the elastic orbital floor fractures and then immediately snaps back, trapping and incarcerating the inferior rectus muscle. The child is incapable of performing an upward gaze, and this is often associated with nausea, vomiting, and bradycardia because of the oculocardial system. Because of nausea and vomiting, this often gets misinterpreted as possible head injury, and it takes several hours before the patient is even seen by an ophthalmologist or an assistant surgeon. So have a high index of suspicion in any child with or without oversense of ocular trauma, nausea and vomiting. Please perform an ocular motility to rule out this white or blue fracture. Can a CT help you take a decision? Not always, because there has been one study that has shown that it is only about 50% of the pediatric fractures the CT is able to detect an entrapment of the orbital musculature, which is then confirmed on orbital exploration. So remember that in 50% of the patients, their CT findings may be absolutely normal. So always give credence to your clinical judgment and your clinical examination rather than blindly believing what the CT shows. Now, what about enophthalmos? Enophthalmos, the retropositioning of the globe, is because of an increased orbital volume. If I see my patient with enophthalmos, do I have to intervene immediately or can I wait and watch? Now we all know every 1 mm increase of the orbital volume results in a 0.9 mm increase in anophthalmia, and a difference in the eye globe of more than 2 mm is visually discernible to the patient and requires intervention. But remember that I also told that during initial clinical examination, the edema and the hemorrhage often obscure the actual anophthalmos that is present, and it again it may be prudent to wait for about 7 to 10 days and allow for the edema to subside. Of course, if on initial evaluation itself you are able to discern an anophthalmos, then there is absolutely no doubt that the patient is having an anophthalmos and would require a surgical intervention even in the presence of edema. Now, predicting globe malposition is quite a challenge, and the surgeon would have to look for clues. In the CT, pay particular attention to signs that are predictive of a developing anophthalmos, which would be multiple wall fractures, mainly the medial wall and the orbital floor, large fractures of the orbital floor greater than 50% of the orbital floor dimension, or severely comminuted in displaced fracture. There are studies that have also shown that fracture lines that extend medial to the infraorbital foramen in a zygomatic complex fracture is indicative of a clue that this patient would require an orbital exploration. Not all orbital floor fractures would result in anophthalmos, especially if this integrity of the suspensory ligaments that we all know about is intact and maintained. Are there any contraindications for surgery? Is there any surgery, any situation where I must not do an orbital surgery? Well, there are no absolute contraindications. The one situation where it may be prudent to just think whether you want to do surgery is a condition in which the patient has got vision in only one eye and that eye has now got an orbital fracture. It may be prudent to discuss with the patient whether he is really interested in proceeding with the surgical intervention because of the risks of the orbital surgery. Now that you have decided and you are quite clear that an intervention is needed, the next question I often ask myself is, do I need help from my oculoplastic colleague, or is this something that I can do on my own? In general, an oculoplastic surgeon would be able to help you in the treatment of the avulsion or tearing of extraocular muscles. But most oculoplastic surgeons tell me that the extraocular muscles are often edematous and retract deep inside the orbit, and they would prefer to do a repair or a reconstruction at a later date. The oculoplastic surgeon would also help you in reassessing the nasolacrimal apparatus and perform a simultaneous repair while you are doing the orbital surgery. And of course, one of their key USPs is their ability to suture excellently some of the complex lid lacerations. Do you need any special instrumentation or equipment to perform orbital surgery? Trying to perform orbital surgery without a good lighting source, with or without loops, is a no-brainer. You have to have a good lighting source to see what's inside the orbit. Corneal shields are a must to prevent any corneal abrasion. Colorado needles help in more precise cutting rather than the usual cotton needles that we use. And you should also consider the use of lid retractors such as Desmeyer and a Jaeger lid plate that would help you retract the orbital tissues with minimal damage. Now, herniation of the periorbital fat is a nuisance during the surgical procedure. To avoid this, there are quite a number of commercial retractors that are available in the market, which one can consider. Otherwise, you different range of our usual malleable retractors should serve the trick in most situations. There have been some publications by maxillofacial surgeons in India, mainly Anshul Rai and Dr. Saravanan, who have suggested simple adjunct alternatives to the orbital retractors, and I would suggest that people go and read up these articles and see if they can use these adjuncts when they are doing orbital surgery. How do I gain surgical access? Now, to a large extent, surgical access to an orbital fracture is dependent upon the surgeon's comfort zone. Okay? Transcutaneous approaches would mainly be the infraorbital, the subciliary, and the subtarsal incisions. Subtarsal incisions seem to be the most popular, but for my experience, what I would say is that I initially started off with the first few cases of orbital surgery by performing an infraorbital 3 or 4, and then moved on to the subtarsal once I was comfortable with the orbital dissection. So it is not necessary that one should always start off with the subtarsal incisions, although those are the most aesthetically pleasing incisions. Of late, I have started trying to do more of my orbital surgeries through a transcongenital approach. The transcongenital approach can even be extended laterally, and this gives an excellent access to the sphenozygomatic suture and the frontozygomatic suture. Thereby, you don't have to put another separate incision in the lateral blow or in the upper eyelid crease. Approaches to the medial wall are also possible through a transcuncular approach. Be careful while performing this incision because you can cause an inadvertent damage to the nasal lacrimal duct. Now, as postgraduates and people who have some experience in orbital surgery, I think we would have all memorized the limits to safe dissection in the orbit. In the medial orbital wall, the landmarks being the anterior lacrimal crest and the anterior and posterior ethmoidal artery. And in the inferior orbital walls and the lateral walls, a safe distance of about 25 to 30 mm, I'm sorry, I think that's a mistake here, is considered to be as a safe distance for orbital dissection. But what one should understand is that many times these guidances are made from dry skulls, and it is difficult for the surgeon to interpret them intraoperatively, especially in a traumatic situation where the landmarks themselves have been disrupted. So how do I go about doing a safe orbital dissection? Now the critical area is the Hammer's key area, which is the confluence of 4 anatomical landmarks, namely the infraorbital nerve, the inferior orbital fissure, the greater wing of the sphenoid, and the superior orbital fissure. Reconstructing the Hammer's key area is the key to orbital dissection. How does one reach the Hammer's key area safely? This has been described by intraorbital dissection by using the infraorbital nerve as the key landmark towards reaching the inferior orbital fissure, and from then on moving medially to reach the lateral promontory or the orbital plate of the palatine bone, which is the key area for placing your reconstruction material, support for your reconstruction material. It is important that when you are performing an intraorbital dissection, you must always remain in a subperiosteal plane. Violating the periosteal plane can result in damage to the inferior oblique musculature. Once you have done an orbital dissection and exposed the fracture, the next question that we often ask ourselves is, does this fracture need a reconstruction or not? In many situations, the comminutions may be small in size, and the mere release of the incarcerated tissues should be more than enough, which is what is done in most situations of a wide-eyed lower fracture. Please remember that you must warn your anesthetist when you are placing the orbital retractor, because this can result in life-threatening bradycardia. And also ask your assistant to keep relieving the pressure generated by the orbital retractor at regular intervals. Believe me, it's very easy to forget that we are exerting a lot of pressure through this orbital retractor. Supposing you have decided to reconstruct, the next question usually asked us is, what is the ideal reconstruction? Now, it is important to understand that the orbital floor is not a straight line structure, but instead has got this sinusoidal shape that slopes upwards medially. And as I told before, reconstructing the Hammer's key area is the key to orbital reconstruction. So, my reconstruction material
should not only be rigid, but be flexible enough to adapt to the contours of the orbit. It must be radio opaque so that I can evaluate it post-operatively. It should be biocompatible and inert, and it should remain stable. Now, I know literature says there's a lot of materials that are being used for orbital reconstruction. But at present, what appears to be the best choice for orbital reconstruction is the titanium orbital mesh with or without a mid-core connection. How do you decide the shape and size of the implant? Now, if you have access to complicated software, you can do a mirroring of the orbits, take a 3D printed skull and adapt your plate orbital mesh so that you do not find any difficulty intraoperatively. If you are a resource-starved department like mine is, you can use a simple jugart where we take a dry skull and put the orbital plate over the dry skull and ensure that the orbital plate is curved in such a way that the S contour of the orbital floor and the medial bulge is recreated. Though not perfect, it does work in many situations and saves you a lot of intraoperative time. Now, once you have placed the implant, how do you know whether you have done a good job? It is very important that the implant must be supported posteriorly, which is the orbital process of the palatine bone, and must preferably have a bony support all around. I personally use a periosteal elevator to physically confirm that there is a good bony support at the posterior end of the orbital mesh. The mesh must be stable, and it is very important to perform a post-suction test before you place in the mesh and after you place in the mesh. Supposing a post-suction test is positive or continues to remain positive after you have placed the orbital mesh, it means that there is still some entrapment that you have missed out. You have to remove the mesh, again re-explore, remove the tissues from that region, put in the mesh again, and confirm that the FDP is negative. Some workers have suggested that you should attempt for a slight overcorrection in anterior posterior dimension to compensate for some relapse that takes place because of the shrinkage of edema and hematoma. But in most situations, it will not be necessary. Should I do closure when I do a transconjunctival incision? Most ophthalmic surgeons say that closure is not absolutely essential. But if an orbital implant is placed, maybe it may be prudent to use a 6-0 vitreal suture. Take care that you are not pulling the periosteum and suturing it to the orbital septum, or you are not causing excessive traction when you are placing sutures. So simple conjunctival sutures should be more than enough. Okay. Also pay attention to soft tissue suspension in the infraorbital and malar region and in the lateral canthal tendon. All these are small steps that help in better post-operative care. What about post-operative care? Do I have to do anything different? Yes. Immediately after the extubation, it is important that you check the patient's vision and the pupillary reflex. And this has to be done probably on an hourly basis for at least the first 6 hours. You can seek the help of your ophthalmology colleagues to help in documentation of this. Ice packs, short-term steroids, frost sutures, head and elevation, these are all maneuvers that you can try for about 24 to 48 hours to minimize the post-operative bleeding. It is important that the patient is advised not to sneeze or blow the nose excessively by keeping the noses closed, as this can suddenly increase the intraorbital pressure and lead to orbital emphysema. So you may want to give also sinus protection measures as an adjunct. Now, not all orbital surgeries are risk-free. There are definitely complications. The most dreaded is that of a post-operative vision loss. Okay. Now, this can generally be avoided by a gentle handling of tissues, a proper selection of the implant shape and size. And it's very important not to try to force into the orbit the plate beyond the posterior limit of the fracture. Remember that the safe limits of orbital dissection demanded that there must be at least a 1 centimeter gap between the optic foramen and the posterior portion of the orbital. Hemostasis is very, very important before you do a closure, because persistent bleeding into the orbital cavity may result in an increase in intraorbital pressure and cause symptoms similar to that of a retrobulbar hematoma. I'm not too sure whether this is very valid nowadays with the titanium orbital meshes, where there are sufficient pores in the mesh that allow for the accumulated blood to drain into the maxillary sinus or into the ethmoid sinus. But still, I think it's prudent to maintain hemostasis before you do a closure. I personally remember that there was one case where when we were operating in our hospital, there was a persistent ooze from the infarctal region that repeatedly bled as we kept manipulating this region despite cauterizing it at regular intervals. So we in fact decided not to go ahead and place an orbital mesh for that patient, and instead took him up 2 weeks later as a secondary reconstructive procedure. Now, there's another situation that can be very unnerving for you. Patient complaining of restricted ocular motility and diplopia after the surgery has been performed. Is this something that you should be worried about? Not really, because in most situations, this restriction in motility and diplopia is more as a result of the muscle edema and the muscle injury that has occurred during your intraorbital dissection and manipulation. In most situations, it should be self-limiting. But remember, you can be sure of this only if you have performed a post-suction test after the orbital implant was placed and confirmed that it was negative, which meant that there was no further entrapment. Are post-operative CTs always necessary? Maybe yes, maybe no, because in most situations you can identify whether you have placed the implant correctly, but maybe it is a good way of quality control and the way you learn how to do your orbital surgery. Post-operative CTs help in a better assessment of the quality of the work that you have done and may also be necessary for medical reasons. What about residual anophthalmos? Now, in most situations, it is because you have not done something right. You have either not repositioned the orbital tissues correctly, you have not placed the orbital implant properly, there's improper support for the implant, or you have not corrected some fractures. Usually, many times the medial orbital wall fractures are left untreated. All these can contribute to residual anophthalmos. But let us suppose that you have done everything perfectly, you have done a fantastic reconstruction, you have got your hammer's key area perfectly, your post-operative CT is something that you can be proud of, but even then it can be very frustrating to see a few weeks later patient has some degree of anophthalmos. This is believed to be as a result of fat atrophy and orbital septal ruptures, and whether an re-intervention is required or not is wholly dependent upon the patient's desire to correct the anophthalmos or not. Other complications would be abnormal lid positions like an ectropion or an entropion, both of which can be avoided by careful placement of incision, and more importantly, careful suturing of the conjunctival tissues, taking care not to exert excessive traction when you are putting the suture. Persistent watering of the eye or epiphora in the post-operative period is expected. It should usually be self-limiting, should stop in about 3 to 4 days time. But if it persists, please check up with your ophthalmology consultant whether there has been any iatrogenic injury to the nasal lacrimal apparatus during your orbital surgery. So finally, what is the take-home message? Orbital surgeries are actually quite challenging, and it is essential that before any orbital surgery, you perform an ophthalmic evaluation and documentation. For diagnosis, a clean slide CT imaging is absolutely essential. Remember, not all patients need surgical intervention. Reassessment after 7 to 10 days would find you not suggesting surgery for a good number of patients. While performing orbital surgery, remember to use appropriate instrumentation, and most critical is gentle soft tissue handling and a proper implant positioning. One of the most frustrating complications is going to be residual anophthalmos that can occur despite your best intervention, and this is something that you should warn your patients. I thank you all for a kind and patient hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Krishnan, for the introduction to various scenarios, decision making, and the basic outline that you have given. Can I have in Anant also?
Yeah, Vivek, hi.
Yeah. Anant, there are a lot of questions here. Yeah. So I'll hand over to Kannan to start off. We'll just have a little bit of discussion now, and then we'll carry on with your presentation.
Sure.
Because we'll whatever questions which are intended out of this presentation, we will answer them first.
Sure.
Yeah. Kannan, can you start off? Kannan, unmute.
You're muted.
Kannan, you're muted.
Sorry. Yeah. Thanks, Vivek. Krishnan, thanks for the presentation. We have some questions ranging from the very basic to the other end. So I'll start off with the simplest which I have got, maybe so that they don't feel left out. Why is subconjunctival hemorrhage flame-shaped is the question. To any one of you, do you want to take that? And then I'll go to radiology. Then there is a couple of radiology questions.
Is it always flame-shaped? I have not paid particular attention to that. The only thing I keep looking for is whether the posterior limit is visible to me or not. I have not paid particular attention to the shape, but this is something that is new to me. I'll go and check up.
Okay, Kannan, I think I will just make a small clarification on that. I also am not sure whether it's actually a flame shape or not. But this question of having a posterior limit or not is quite confusing when you read it from the textbook. So for sake of clarity for PG students, let me just address what exactly do you mean as a posterior limit and what is actually a limited one. Let us say you have a small hemorrhagic spot on the conjunctiva. Okay, that is one which has limits. It is not that once you pull the lateral vestibule of the eye and then you can't see it behind. There is no way that there is nothing there which will stop or go beyond that. So that is not the posterior limit. The limits are when you have a circumscribed hemorrhagic spot within the conjunctiva, that is called the posterior limit. It is limit on all sides. If you don't have that and then it looks as if it is spreading, then it is one which does not have limits. The simple reason is any hemorrhagic spot which has a limit means it is a localized injury. Anything which does not have a limit means there is a subperiosteal ooze which is just traversing across because of the pressure. That is the only difference. That is just for PGs as a clarity.
I think Dr. Anand, that's a very good point you made, because when I was a postgraduate student myself, that this was quite a confusing part, and it took me several years to understand what I had understood was actually wrong, you know.
Yeah, no, that clarifies it. No, I think that is clearly put. So that way, we are not interested in the shape, basically. We just want to know if the sign is there or not and why, what it means. So this one, again, to both of you, for about volumetric assessment of the orbit, both when it's fractured and after reconstruction. Is there a software or is there a way with available CT, can you volumetrically easily assess it for the surgeons?
Okay. Krishan, can I take that?
Yeah, please.
Okay.
Yeah.
See, most of us nowadays are not using CT films to assess fractures. It is a good practice which we want people to follow when they start looking at DICOM images. Okay, so when you start looking at how to interpret DICOM images, there are a lot of free viewers. One good viewer for Windows-based laptops is Radiant Viewer, okay? And one good one for Mac-based platforms is a software called Horus. Now, all these softwares are coming up with built-in ROI markers, range of information, okay? It's called field of interest or range of information markers. If you are able to mark points on the cross-sectional CTs in subsequent images and then do what is called as a collimation of the whole set of images, automatically you get area and volume. it's a slightly technique sensitive thing which you might have to learn from YouTube, but it is always available on the YouTube and it takes no more than 10 minutes for anybody who's tech savvy to master it. So for PGs or youngsters who are interested in finding volumes, yes, it is a good method. I won't say it is foolproof because it does not cover all the indentations which are there, but to a limitation, let us say the orbit is 40 millimeters and you are able to take 40 scans and then map the ROAs in all the 40 mm scans, then you have a fairly good assessment of the volume. I hope this is able to answer that question.
Yeah, no, I think that should be okay. So we need DICOM images and we need technology and we need the software. That is the only
But way. There are freewares which are facilitating this quite comfortably these days. Earlier it used to be a challenge, now it's much more easy.
Then, what, again, sticking to...
Dr. Kannan, what actually happens many times is when patients come to our hospital, like Dr. Hamilton, in case they have a huge film in front of them and they say that another doctor has told that you have a fracture or which needs treatment. Like he says, it's very difficult to make clinical judgment on just a CT film, and you are forced to take a second CT scan if DICOM images are not available.
Having said that, just in the same line, can I add, what would you advise them when you are requesting for a CT and when you think your area of interest is orbit? What would you tell them to? Is there a specific instruction you give to them with your to your radiologist to help with your DICOM planning and everything? What is written in the CT form, basically? Anand,
I'll tell you something funny that happens in our hospitals. Irrespective of what you write in the CT scan, CT form is completely up to what the technician does when the patient gets wheeled into the CT room. I'll give you an example. There was a patient in ophthalmology with an ophthalmic problem, and the ophthalmology people wanted a CT of the orbit, and they sent the patient for the CT of the orbits, and the patient came back to CT of the thorax. And they were wondering why a CT of the thorax was taken, because the patient was first initially admitted with CTVS and then transferred to ophthalmology. And the technician just saw the patient was first admitted in CTVS and he decided, okay, they must be wanting a CT thorax, you know. So sometimes it's been very frustrating. We would specifically ask 0.6 mm, 1 mm. But when the CT images come, you find that they are not what you ask for, then you have to go to the radiology department and sit in their packed room and try to get these images out.
With regard to your request, is there specific, something specific like 0.6 mm cut or less than or something specific you want to say?
A good description falls on the clinical presentation of the patient. Now, let us say you're looking at orbital symptoms alone and you are expecting nothing more than an orbital blowout. You want to rule out only that because your clinical findings do not suggest anything else. So the area of vision is very restricted. Let us say it's orbit and zygoma. Okay. Or versus another patient who's got a panfacial injury and then you want to study the orbit also there. I think the primary initiative is to figure out what is the field of area that you want to cover. If it is going to be a panfacial injury and the area that you need to cover is larger, then I think you need to go for what is called as a screening scan of 1 mm cuts. That is a screening scan, which will give you a good definition of not only the face, but also the orbit. But for somebody who is going to do specialized orbital surgery for a redo, especially a redo surgery, a revision surgery, and they want to study the orbit more in detail, then we are looking at much smaller cut slices, which is 0.6 or even 0.3 at times when you want to do a PSI implants and all that. So I think it basically depends on the clinical scenario you're looking at. But on the whole, for a good assessment using DICOM images and a good DICOM player, 1 mm cuts is ample enough for most of the information that we need.
Okay, fine. So now that should be okay. So you just need 1 mm cut or around that area to help you with the planning or even with your modeling or PSIs, even to make PSIs. So that's fine. There is a question even on clinical assessment about do you actively look for the lacrimal apparatus, examine them actively yourself at that time, or if so, what would you do to assess the lacrimal apparatus during your initial, during the patient's initial presentation, or would you send them to the ophthalmologist?
I would send them to the ophthalmologist.
Okay. I follow is... if you have a clinical presentation which mandates looking at the lacrimal apparatus once more, they are based on the fracture pattern. Let us say it's a zygomatic orbital fracture, and I'm not worried much about the lacrimal apparatus there clinically. But let us say you're looking at a naso orbitoethmoid type fracture, then the clinical indication itself puts us in a situation where you are interested in looking at the lacrimal apparatus more. You look for clinical signs, but I would also totally accept with Krishnan in the fact that it is better examined more in detail by a person who's more trained than us. They will perform all the tests. However, if you want to facilitate it, you can make a note and then send it across saying you are interested in that examination also.
Could it be part of your CT, like secondary you were discussing when you're asking for the 1 mm CT, could always try and inject a dye and get them to do if, to see it so instead of.
Yes.
I
think the basic criteria is between whether you're looking at a primary injury or a secondary injury. Okay, primary injuries, it is very rare for us to get a blocked duct. Usually it's a transected duct. You know, if it's a transection in the region of the anatomy that you're looking at, then you're looking at a transected duct, which is automatically going to mandate us asking for it. But if you're looking at a secondary case and you have clinical signs of a blocked ductal system, then like what Dr. Kannan is advising, you can ask for a specialized scan, which is called as a CT-DCG, which is a CT-dacryocystogram, which is the gold standard for evaluating nasolacrimal duct apparatus. So I think that's a way to ask for it, depending on what is the clinical presentation that you're seeing.
Dr. Anand, in your experience, do you request your oculoplastic surgeon to simultaneously treat an NLD injury in a NOE fracture, or do they prefer to do it as on a secondary basis?
Normally, we would do it as a staged procedure. We don't do a procedure together, but yes, in two cases, we have done a conjoint procedure also. And if the ophthalmologist is very comfortable and ready to work with us, because remember that placement of the implant has a big stress on the reconstructed area. That is the only thing. So if you're able to have a good teammate who is accepting that it is okay, otherwise it's better to stage it and do it. One important factor clinically is if you have a ductal system which is blocked, it is going to be a persistent source of infection for your plate. That is one thing you have to remember. So clear off the infection first, make the area sterile and clean for us to put the implant inside.
Vivek, do you want to say anything?
Yeah, maybe a couple of more questions. There are a lot of questions. I think, Anant, you will probably be addressing these in your talk. So I'm not taking those questions. But however, in this regard, there are a couple of things that we would probably clarify, because Krishnan, you did mention about the mesh usage. There's a question that will a mesh can be used to support the medial wall of the orbit?
Yeah, so I think these companies come with separate meshes for the medial wall of the orbits, or you can just take a complex orbital mesh and cut off the portion that you need for to reconstruct the medial wall. The important thing when reconstructing the medial wall is the mistakes that I have made. It's important to understand that the medial walls and the lateral walls are in an angle of 45 degrees to each other, and both the medial walls are actually parallel to each other. So there has been one instance where I got my angulation completely wrong, and the postoperative CT showed that the medial mesh was into the ethmoid sinus and not into where I wanted to place it. So I kind of realized that you have to resist the temptation to follow the angulation of the lateral wall and end up moving more medially. And another thing that I forgot to mention is that as maxillofacial surgeons, we have this tendency of wanting to adapt the plate nicely to the fracture. Now, in an orbital fracture, I think you should not be looking for this adaptation. If you have done a good reconstruction, there should actually be a gap between your titanium orbital mesh and the fractured orbital floor. So resist the temptation of wanting to push it down further and making it flush with the fractured orbital floor.
Anand, do you think there's a role of custom-made implants in these situations?
There is definitely a role for customized implants in this situation, but I think I would wait for my presentation because I have a good case scenario there to discuss, which would mandate when to use.
There's one more question related to mesh. Do we need to remove a mesh in a pediatric patient at a later date? And if so, or if not?
Anand, you want to take that?
Sure. Okay. See, when it comes to pediatric age groups, let us first understand the growth of the orbit and the globe. Within the first 2 years, almost 80% of the growth is completed. And then within the next 4 years, which means by the time the child reaches 6 or 7 years, almost 90% of the growth is complete. So we are actually not looking at a procedure which is going to impede growth in any form or cause a problem to that. It is basically whether the child is going to sustain that mesh for a longer period of time or not. If the child is very young and the defect is small, we have ample support of the bony walls, then a resorbable mesh is good enough, or anything for that matter, even a proline mesh is good. But if the defect is large, even in a child between 2 and 6 years of age, and you do need a lot of support, then you do put a titanium mesh. Only thing is, there are different sizes in which titanium meshes are currently available. Choose a smaller one. If you want, try to custom fit it into the CT by virtual planning, check it, and then put it inside. Then you don't have to remove it. I don't see a reason why there is a problem with that, because it does not impede the growth. Only thing we should worry about is a child is in a phase where they are prone for more contact injuries because of playing. So we need to keep them informed that they have to be very, very careful about that. Other than that, I don't see a big contraindication.
Yeah, probably, Anand, Kannan, we'll take one or two more questions and then we'll move on.
Yeah, just on this thing, Anand, both of you, either one, safe limits across walls and what if you can't find the posterior?
Yeah, that question is being repeated by many here. Okay, what will be your maximum depth? And if there is no posterior ledge, what do we do?
I think Krishnan has given a fabulous diagram with anatomical basis as how to approach this. He's quoted a beautiful article on Evans on safe dissection for the orbit. And that article is also good. You start with the lateral wall, go on to the promontory, and then get into the hammer's area. However, let's just wait for the other presentation, because for advanced orbital surgery, we've split the topics into two. The first will cover up the basic formats with general decision making, which has been so elegantly presented by Krishnan. The second part, we will try to cover the advances, which will give you small tips and pointers on how to go deep into the orbit.
I remember this question was asked in one of the AO programs, and Dr. Gopalakrishnan, who has a lot of experience with orbital surgery, said that he had never come across a case where there was no availability of a posterior ledge. So he said, if you look hard enough, you will always find a posterior ledge to put your plate in. It means you are not looking hard enough.
Yeah. Kannan, I think, shall we take up if there are further questions in the end of the discussion?
Yeah, just one clinical question before we go on. There was a question just to bring it up. How do you assess the, is there a way you assess the AP position of the globe intraoperatively? Somebody has asked, so
AP maybe position
of the globe. Maybe pull out enough thalamus, or if you have sufficiently come out, or it is still sunken. That is what I can infer.
I think textbooks say that you examine the patient through a worm view after you have completed the entire surgery. But it's all subjective, you see, because there's going to be a lot of edema after your surgical procedure. It's very difficult to exactly say that whether you've done a good job or not. There are some people who said that the eye should look indeed a little bit proptotic after you've completed the procedure. So some degree of overcorrection is always better. But I think that's an individual choice.
Can I make a small point on that? See, there is one small clinical test that you can follow when you want to check this the level of the globes intraoperatively, and that is called Hirschberg's test. Hirschberg test is nothing but shining a torch, you know, from a distance onto the patient's eyes from a perpendicular level. The patient is lying down. You just hold a torch perpendicular to the globes and then shine a torch. So the reflection of the torch light on both the pupils will give you top, bottom, medial, and lateral shifts. It's called Hirschberg test. It is available. If you want to see AP discrepancies, what you need to do is, instead of perpendicular, make it at 60 degrees or 45 degrees so that you will see a reflection when you see from the top or bottom in a slightly superior inferior level. That, because it's very difficult to eyeball the corneal levels, but it is easier to eyeball the light lamp levels. So if one light appears to be higher than the other level, you are going to look at a slight discrepancy, but I would also accept what Krishnan says. You always want the operator diet to look slightly proctotic. Now, how slight is slight? Nobody can define it, but you want it to look slightly fuller without it being tense.
One question that is there, if supposing there's a recti entrapment and if you have a delayed performing surgery, what could happen? What could be the fate of this muscle?
Muscle usually would undergo fibrosis.
Yeah.
And the option now would be patient undergoes what is known as a strabismus surgery by the oculoplastic surgeon, where this muscle is the opposing muscle is either weakened or strengthened to ensure that this muscular imbalance is prevented. And I think they also use prism glasses to correct for this dysplasia. So again, it depends upon the degree of entrapment, how much it is affecting the patient's day-to-day life. Ophthalmologists in general tend to give attention only to diplopia that is in the downward gaze, so that makes reading or walking or driving a vehicle extremely difficult. Usually they tend to ignore diplopia in extreme gazes and try not to do much about it, at least in my hospital.
Kannan, I think we'll wind up the questions here.
Sure. Yes.
Anant, over to you, Anant.
Okay. Thanks a lot. So I'll just start
Before Anant starts, I just have an announcement for the participants. We'll just share a feedback link at the end of the presentations so that the participants can fill in the feedback so that we get their data and we can share the e-certificates later. So at the end of the presentation, I'll share the link in the chat box. Thank you. Over to you, Anant.
Thanks, Jim. So let me just start my screen share. Okay, I hope this is visible.
Yeah, it's fine.
Okay. Thanks for staying with us, all of you, and I hope you guys enjoy and benefit from this discussion. And like I said earlier, this particular topic, we have already troubleshooted it once, and then we decided to make it more interesting. So Krishnan has so elegantly demonstrated the basic decision makings, which are extremely important for the PGs as well as the budding surgeons of today. And we thought we will have a good session of questions like what we had now, and then we will go into the slightly advanced version of orbital surgery. And following which, we will again reconvene for a final session of questions if there are any. So what I'm going to do is part two, and this is the scope of my presentation. I will be handling orbital emergencies and their basic management, tips and tricks for efficient surgery, recent advances in orbital surgery, as well as we will have a few case scenarios to make you understand what are the different presentations that we can have and how in general we can take a look at it and handle them. Now, when it comes to orbital emergencies, these are pretty much most of us come across in textbooks. A few of us have seen them, and a few of us are actually eager to learn about them. Few of us have managed them predictably as well as unpredictably. When we look at all these scenarios, let us group the first three into one group, because the most important facets of management for these are neurological symptoms. The superior orbital fissure syndrome, the orbital apex syndrome, as well as traumatic optic neuropathy primarily demonstrate neurological symptoms, while retrobulbar hemorrhage conventionally is something like a compartment syndrome. The classical oculovagal response of a white eye blowout, which is again being discussed by Krishnan, I will take a small extra peep into that. And then the last one, which Dr. Vivek yesterday asked me to add, it's a very valid point of penetrating globe injuries. How do you manage penetrating globe injuries? So this is just a simple chart. Most of us know the theory for all these things. Just to make you understand more clearly, traumatic optic neuropathy is nothing but damage exclusively to the optic nerve. So please remember that all the signs associated with traumatic optic neuropathy are with the optic nerve. And there is a small term here, which is called RAPD. It is relative afferent pupillary defect, which we will see again in the later part of this particular presentation, and try to understand how useful it is both as a diagnostic measure as well as a clinical measure. Now, if you notice, the second one is superior orbital fissure syndrome, which is devoid of any optic nerve involvement, but all the other nerves pretty much are involved, which is 3, 4, and 6. And it has other sensory problems also associated with the motor issues which are there here. The last one is everything which includes traumatic optic neuropathy as well as superior orbital fissure syndrome. So that is why I have marked the table like this. The first one is TON, which is exclusively optic nerve. The second one is SOF, which is other than optic nerve, all the other neurological findings. And the third one is orbital apex syndrome, which has pretty much everything that needs to be covered in a orbit for emergencies. Now, taking you through a few cases, this is a classical case of a superior orbital fissure syndrome. You can see the degree of ptosis, which is there. And then you can see ophthalmoplegia, of course, not complete ophthalmoplegia in this patient. He has the lateral rectus, which is still functional because the sixth nerve has been spared. However, you can see that the pupil is dilated here, if you're able to make out that in good clarity. This is an orbital apex syndrome. Again, if you see from the outside, they look pretty similar to the superior orbital fissure syndrome. We have the same features of ptosis, which is presenting. If you open the eye and see, it will have again ophthalmoplegia. But I've added a CT here to show you what makes the small difference here. This is the superior orbital fissure on the normal side, which is the right side. And this is the superior orbital fissure on the left side, which has been completely displaced and reoriented in form by the lateral wall of the orbit, which has not actually fractured along the sphenozygomatic as it usually does. A greater lateral vector has actually displaced the entire sphenoid into the orbit, reorienting not only the superior orbital fissure, but also damaging the optic nerve. Let's take a closer look at the CTs. You can see a complete occlusion of the optic canal here. It's very well appreciated here. That's because the whole sphenoid has moved inside and telescoped. And this is the reorientation of the superior orbital fissure, which has been done by the wings of these sphenoids. So this will pretty much cause all the features and neurological symptoms that are associated with the optic nerve, as well as the other nerves which course through the orbit. The last one is traumatic optic neuropathy. So I have taken an exclusive case, which shows you a foreign body or a broken bony fragment, which is impinging on the optic nerve. So this is direct injury to the optic nerve alone. Well, the patient does not seem to have any other problems when you look at him clinically. He looks seemingly normal, maybe with a bit of swelling because of the injury that he's received to the lateral part of the face. But other than that, he had a complete loss of vision on the affected side. So these are the clinical presentations that you can come up with. When you look at the management scenario for all these, they are pretty much common in the way we have to look at it, because like I said, most of the symptoms are neurological in basis. So you need to think on how to manage. Conventionally, there are three modes of management which have been dictated. One is observation, wherein you just wait and watch. The second one is medical management, and the third one is surgical management. When you're looking at medical management, there are two schools that you need to understand. One is the steroid therapy. And the second one is, if you have an associated compartment syndrome, which is usually seen as part in superior orbital fissure syndrome as well as orbital apex syndrome, you have to handle the compartment syndrome also. I have not mentioned the compartment syndrome here because I will be handling it along with the retrobulbar hemorrhage. Here, when you look at it, the main onus is on the steroid therapy. There are still a lot of people who believe in megadose steroid therapy. And this is a recommendation which has been given by the American Association of Ophthalmologists. It starts with a huge dose of 30 milligrams per kg body weight bolus, followed by 5 milligrams per kg body weight per hour for the next 23 hours. That's a large amount of steroids, and you need to think about giving this. However, there are enough controversies in relation to the use of steroids for head and spine injuries, and this will be a good chance to debate over that. There are the crash trials, which has been submitted by the neurosurgeons who handle head injuries, and they strongly recommend no steroid usage because it has been shown to increase mortality in the peri-traumatic period. While the spine surgeons still believe that there is a big role of steroids in getting their patients back into function. So this is a debate that we can always take up later. However, we do use steroids to a small dose, not to the dose which is indicated here, but 1 milligram per kg body weight of prednisolone is what we follow as a loading bolus dose. And we do not follow an hourly dosage. We split it into 3 or 4 doses depending on the severity of the problem. The next level of management is surgical decompression, which can be done not only for the optic canal, but also for the superior orbital fissure. It generally can be done as an open surgical procedure through the transsphenoid approach, or it can be done as a closed fest procedure through the transethmoid approach. So there are two methods to decompress the posterior end of the orbital cone. And when you look at statistics, that's the most important and interesting find. An international consensus on orbital optic nerve trauma was actually performed, and then they found out that when you look at all the three modalities, whether it is wait and watch, whether it is medical, or whether it is surgical intervention, the recovery rate is only about 30 to 35%, which is 1/3. So irrespective of what your treatment modality is, you can't definitively say that this is going to win the match for the patient. All you need to do is institute whatever you feel is right, and then wait and watch, keep following them, and do any additional help that they might require. For the sake of PGs, I've added some references which are very interesting. If you want, you can take a screenshot of this. It will be available on YouTube because the whole course is being recorded also. However, the first one is of great interest. This is the crash trial, which I've spoken about. It's published in Lancet with a sample size of in excess of 10,000 patients. And then the next one is the National Acute Spinal Cord Injury Study, which is also published in Neurotrauma. It's a fantastic read. And the fourth one, which is the American Academy of Ophthalmology, Neuro-Ophthalmology, Practicing Ophthalmological Learning System, is another thing which is very interesting and can be a good source of information for all the PGs as well as budding surgeons. Now we've handled the neurological deficit problems, let's come to the compartment syndrome, of which retrobulbar hemorrhage is the most common one seen, and sometimes is actually taken as a critical orbital emergency where we are forced to jump and then intervene straight away. Let us first understand what causes the retrobulbar hemorrhage. They are not big bleeding arteries in normal. The most common reasons are ophthalmic veins, ethmoidal vessels, minor capillaries, which are from the central artery of the retina, which is in the center of the cone. But these are not major big bleeders. Normally, they are self-limiting and do generally stop. Clinical indications will have some degree of tenseness of the globe, which is in relation to the kind of injury that has been associated. When you have an exclusive intra-orbital injury, the chance of it becoming tense is higher, while when you have a associated impure injury, where a zygoma is fractured or NOE is fractured or a maxilla is fractured, the chance for it to become tense is lesser. So the clinical decision is based on that. Another important finding in this is increased IOP, which is intraocular pressure. The normal range is between 10 and 20. If it goes in excess of 30, then you're looking at immediate intervention in terms of saving of vision. What you need to look at, and it's very critical in these situations, is hourly monitoring of vision, and you're going to look for progressive loss of vision. That's the simplest test that you need to follow over an hourly basis so that you understand whether there is a need for intervention or not. If there is a need for intervention, when you're checking with progressive loss of vision, what you need to do is you have to find out whether the optic nerve is getting compressed or there is a central retinal artery occlusion, which are the main causes for the problem with vision. CT scans and MRIs are the key points for diagnosis. They've already been discussed well by Krishnan. And let's have a look at how a retrobulbar hemorrhage looks clinically. So when you're looking at this here, there is a left-sided retrobulbar hemorrhage. You can see good degree of proptosis and intraconal bleeding on all the sections, the axial section, the coronal section, as well as the sagittal section. Of course, this is an impure blowout of the orbital floor along with the comminuted zygoma. So the degree of tension, though it looks pretty significant, there is something called as tenseness of the globe. When you press the globe should be slightly movable within the socket. So that is a clinical test which you can perform. If you're able to have a very tense, or if you perceive a very tense globe, then you're looking at a more grievous situation. While if it is slightly compressible, you know that it is a give and take. In this particular case, we will find out later as to what we have done. However, the schedule or the sequence that you want to follow for management would probably take a course like this. You're looking at an hourly assessment of vision. When you're looking at vision, what exactly are you assessing? The first thing that you want to look at is the visual acuity, and the second one is visual field. Now make a difference between the two. Visual acuity is the sense of perception of vision in its entirety, and field is how far can you see. Now, remember that in certain patients, the acuity might be very good, while the field or the peripheral loss of vision may still be there, which you may not be able to perceive. So don't think that if the patient says, I'm able to see well, I'm able to see things clearly, don't take that things are going well. When you are going to review him on an hourly basis, make sure not only is the acuity understood well, but also the fields. You have to take a confrontational field test so that you are able to justify that all the fields in his vision are good and well maintained. The last one is color monitoring, because that's one of the most sensitive indicators of retinal damage. So when you have a central artery of retina occlusion, the most common thing that would change immediately is color vision. And when you're looking at compartment syndrome management, medical management for IOP increase is automatically like the way we handle a head injury patient. You put them on carbonic anhydrase inhibitors as well as diuretics. And you can add steroids also if at all you feel that there is already a small degree of neurological damage which is there. When you have progressive loss of vision and it stays positive, you're not looking at medical management anymore. You have to go ahead and then decompress the orbit for the release of the compartmental hemorrhage. And this can be done most commonly with lateral cantholysis. Now let's try to understand why is lateral cantholysis so commonly used. The simple reason is the most common cause of retrobulbar hemorrhage in our setting is because of zygomatic orbital injuries and the tendency for the ophthalmic veins to bleed in and then cause a hemorrhage. So that is why we are going more towards the lateral side. Well, there are some isolated injuries where you can have the ethmoidal arteries going off. Then the lateral cantholysis is not the best method. You can even do a modified Lynch approach. If you're looking at something which is overflowing from the top, you can even do a sub-brow approach, which is just below the supraorbital rim. So remember that decompression necessarily does not mean that you have to do it with a lateral cantholysis. No, it is not so. You can decompress the orbit in many ways. All you need to do is open the cone so that the intracorneal fluid comes up. And it can be done either with a 270 degree approach, either a medial Lynch approach or a top superiorly based subbrow approach or even a lateral cantholysis as we classically read. The next one is an oculovagal response or what is called as a white eye blowout. Again, mentioned by Krishnan, it is more common in the pediatric and young adult group. It is considered a pediatric emergency when the child goes through repeated bouts of nausea and severe vomiting with bradycardia due to the vagal response. Okay, there are mixed responses when you're asked about treating them with vagolytics. Of course, you can treat them with atropine and glycopyrrolate. Glycopyrrolate is preferred. It is given at this dose. This is the recommended dose. And it can be given both IV as well as orally, depending on the status of the child. But does it cause good remission of the symptoms? No. Primarily, it is used to handle the nausea and the vomiting part, but the bradycardia does not seemingly get arrested with the vagolytics. So a better way of doing that is to give what is called as a retrobulbar block. Okay, so what happens is a retrobulbar block is given by most ophthalmologists to perform akinetic surgery, which means all the muscles go into paresis, sparing the optic nerve alone. So they are able to comfortably work on their field. So it's a very common block given by the ophthalmologists. So you can ask them to infuse a retrobulbar block, which will actually create a parasympathetic blockade from the ciliary ganglion. And that will automatically cut down the stimulus for the bradycardia. So that's the simplest method that you can handle a pediatric emergency. If it states as an emergency and you're not able to get the child into the theater straight away, what you need to do is ask your ophthalmologist to sedate the child and then create So keep the child in a comfortable status and then try to infuse a retrobulbar block. Though easier said than done. But this is a good idea to reduce the brady. And this can also be used as a good clinical measure when you are sometimes experiencing severe bradycardia during your surgical procedure because of your oculocardiac reflex. Now, let us say you're doing an intraorbital surgery and suddenly you see that there are repeated bouts of vagal responses because you're handling the muscles. And then you're finding it difficult to operate. Then again, a retrobulbar block or even infiltration with lidocaine into the posterior space is a good method of stopping your stimulus for a vagal response. The next one is if you're able to locate your periorbital tissue or muscular entrapments on the CT, go ahead and plan for a surgery. If not, and still the child is actually showing restricted motility, then like what has already been explained, do not think that the CTs will show every entrapment in its totality. So take a clinical decision, go ahead, explore and release the entrapped tissue so that the child is comfortable. Because any delay in release of the incarcerated muscle especially shows bad outcomes in time to come. They show a lot of scarring, and then you might have to do a secondary procedure like a strabismus surgery or a muscle recession to balance the movement of the extraocular muscles. The last one in terms of orbital emergencies is penetrating globe injury. Now, let us say you have a penetrating globe injury and the globe has got ruptured. What exactly will you see? Does it cause immediate loss of vision? In certain cases, yes. In certain cases, no. If there is only a leak of the aqueous, then it is not a problem. In most cases, if it's a small tear, the ophthalmologists or the oculoplastic surgeons do what is called as a primary scleral suturing, which in about 60% of the cases is able to save vision. Okay, but the pitfall for this is as you wait and watch, they usually undergo what is called as thysical changes, which means the globe starts shrinking. Okay, in some cases the globe does not shrink and then the patient is able to maintain vision for a much longer time. In certain cases, when the injury is grievous, the globe starts shrinking, which is then termed as a thysical globe. And thysical globes cause a lot of problems, not only for vision, but also in terms of aesthetics as well as function when the patient is perceiving normal binocular vision. So then you have to make a clinical decision as to what you need to proceed with. In most cases, they go for what is called as an evisceration. Okay. Now, in this point of time, I wanted to clarify clearly what is the difference between these three terms. What is evisceration, what is enucleation, and what is excentration? Now, these are terms which are very commonly used, but in most instances, they are used as misnomers. They are used for the other one without intending to mean them. So evisceration is classically seen here, where only the internal viscera of the eye or the globe or the bulb is removed, okay, and the sclera is maintained. Okay, the sclera is maintained. Now, this is the least invasive form of removal of the globe, if you want to tell it as such. So that is called evisceration, where the sclera is maintained and you remove the internal contents, which is called as evisceration. The next one is enucleation. Enucleation is when you feel that the sclera is more prone for infection, you cannot save it, and it is a delayed presentation to you. What they do is they remove the entire globe or the bulb in totality, leaving only the contents, internal contents and appendages intact, which means all the extraocular muscles are left intact and then tied up into a bundle, or they are attached to the conformer at a later point of time. So when you remove the bulb in toto with the scleral component, that is called as enucleation. Excentration is the last one, which is usually preserved for tumors where you have entire removal of the orbital contents, including the orbital adnexa, the muscles, everything, fat, everything is cleansed off the orbital cavity, and that is called as excentration. So generally what happens is after primary suturing, if there is a thysical globe or a shrunken globe and the patient does not have good vision, he's got deteriorating vision, he's losing it, and he is having problems with it, they will have phantom eye pains which are initiating to form. Even though the globe is there, it will produce severe amount of pain. So these kind of situations warrant us for an evisceration or an enucleation at times if there is infection, and then the patient goes for a prosthetic rehabilitation. Just to show you a case, this is a thysical globe which later had to be eviscerated and then followed up with a conformer orbital floor reconstruction and a prosthetic rehabilitation. Now, Kannan and Vivek, we thought we will break for a small session of questions here.
Yeah, sure.
So if there are any, we will take it now.
Yeah. Kannan, do you want to start off, please?
Yes, Anand, we'll keep this brief because I think we have to keep going and most of the questions will repeat. So is there an appropriate time when you will schedule retrobulbar hemorrhage, like you have seen the patient? Is there an indication when you will think I'll go now, or what is your clinical criteria to thinking I'll wait, medically I'll manage?
Okay. Now, as I've said already, retrobulbar hemorrhage is a considered emergency, but not a considered emergency for surgery. So you, the patient has to be seen as soon as the patient presents. They have to be put on an observation chart. Point zero, the patient has to be assessed for visual acuity, visual fields, as well as color vision. Okay, and a complete ophthalmic evaluation has to be performed, and then they will be reviewed on an hourly basis. So what you need to do is at least for 3 hours, they have to be monitored. The preferable time is 3 to 6 hours. If they show deterioration of acuity, fields, or color vision, you're going to look at a damaging situation, then you're going to intervene straight away. If not, you put them on palliative medicine, like I've already suggested, and wait and watch.
Dr. Anand, could you please clarify if a patient comes with a thyroid globe 7 to 10 days with a zygomatic complex fracture referred by an ophthalm colleague, would you still go ahead and do an orbital floor reconstruction of the titanium mesh, considering that his eye is going to be virtually non-functional?
Yeah. Okay, this is actually a very interesting question I think Krishnan has raised. Now, most of us feel that if the patient has an anophthalmic globe, okay, anophthalmic orbit, where there is no globe, or there is a thysical eye where the eye has shrunk to a small extent or more extent, we do not need to do any orbital floor reconstruction. No, this is not so. This is actually a misconception. Please understand that the patient has already lost his function. He needs at least the aesthetic value to be given back to him. Most of the large scale blowouts, as well as impure blowouts, which are commonly associated with a thysical globe or an anophthalmic orbit, do need reconstruction so that the conformer and the prosthesis will have adequate positional stability. If you do not have the floor and the infraorbital rim in the right place, the vestibule of the lid will not fall in the right place. It is something like our dentures. You know, if you don't have the ridges in the right place, the lip will not fall in the right place. So similarly, if you don't have the infraorbital rim and the floor in the right place, the conformer that is put inside and the lid position and the prosthetic shell position will not be in the right place. So in our experience, I'm sorry, I'm quoting our experience here. In our experience, now we have started learning that the outcome of aesthetics in terms of non-reconstructed anophthalmic orbits and thysical globes is actually bad. So last three and a half years, we've started reconstructing all of them, and then we are documenting it for a publication. Most probably you'll hear from us soon. We have close to about 35 cases which have been documented, and the results are fabulous.
Dr. Anand, in such a situation, would you just concentrate on getting the orbital frame in position and then do the floor reconstruction when the ophthalmologist do it, or would you go ahead and do everything at one shot and then refer them back to your ophthalmology colleague?
Okay, if it is an intact sclera and non-infected sclera, then you can go ahead with the conformer plus floor reconstruction straight away. But if you have a sclera which is infected, then you need to do an enucleation and then create a bed for us to manage the prosthesis later. So what we will do is we will do an enucleation, put a split skin graft, cover that area, create a good milieu for us to later reconstruct the orbit with a prosthetic component or a conformer plus prosthetic shell.
Anand, we'll have just two quick questions and then proceed soon. You were mentioning about intraocular pressure. Is there any way to assess it?
Yeah, you have tonometry.
Yeah, no. What I'm trying to say is, now at what stage would you decide to go ahead and explore?
If there is any emergency, you have to see. Always let us get this point straight. Any person with a zygoma injury or a orbital injury needs what is called as 8-point ophthalmic assessment, which is given by the American Association of Ophthalmology. It is readily available on the internet. Most PGs are free to go straight away and then look at it. It's called 8-point ophthalmic assessment, and it involves tonometry as a very important point. There is no role for not doing it. You have to do tonometry and then assess intraocular pressure straight away. For any patient who has undergone a zygomatic orbital or a pure orbital fracture.
This question was just intended so that the postgraduates are aware of this, that yes, things are available like this. And the next quick question is regarding this nerve block that you said, retrobulbar. Yes. There's a question that where would you give it?
Okay, the retrobulbar block is not something we commonly give because we are worried about injuring the sclera. But actually what happens is, let me see, am I visible on the video?
You are visible.
Okay, great. So let us say this is the outer canthal limit, okay, and this is the infraorbital rim. You need to give it at the point of intersection from the line drawn from the outer canthus to the infraorbital rim, and then at a 10 degree tilt from the horizontal plane with the syringe going from bottom to up, and then you are supposed to go parallel to the bulb, behind the bulb to about 28 millimeters inside, and then inject it. Okay, this is the technique which is to be followed. Have I given a retrobulbar block? No, I have never given a retrobulbar block. There are two blocks that you can give. One is called as a retrobulbar block, and the second one is called a peribulbar block. Both of these are intended to be, the retrobulbar block especially is intended to be an intraconal injection. And it has to be given exclusively laterally, because if you go medially, you have a high chance of blocking the optic nerve also. Okay, now that is not something to be done. So here, if you go lateral approach, then you are safe. You are supposed to infiltrate into that intraconal space, and then it produces akinesia, which means all the muscles of extraocular movement are paralyzed, and you have the autonomic blockade also.
Okay, Anand, I think we'll proceed. Yeah?
Yeah, sure. Okay. The next section, we will handle small tips and tricks for efficient surgery in and around the orbit. And the first one is instrumentation. The second one is protection for the globe and soft tissue. And the third one is techniques which will help you in deep orbital dissection. Dr. Krishnan has actually wonderfully elicited what all instrumentation that can be used to make your surgery comfortable. However, these are things I would want to stress. If you are going to take orbital surgery very seriously, then I need to tell you that you need to have a kit for it. It does not work well with the general maxillofacial equipment that we have. You need to have a specialized orbital kit, and it is all miniaturized. Okay, we need to get a hang of how to use them. What I've indicated here are conjunctival forceps. This is called as a rectus forceps, with which you can comfortably identify and hold the medial, lateral, superior, and inferior rectuses, so the recti muscles, so that you can tag them. And then this is a regular tooth forceps, which is small in size. You have a good Steven scissors. You have a Castro Evo pattern scissors, which are small and very comfortable to use in that limited space. You have retractors, which already Krishnan has told, the common copper malleable, the Demar, and the cat's paw. These are the essential instruments that you need to have in your kitty. When it comes to cautery, Krishnan has already talked about the Colorado probe. What makes the Colorado probe such a beautiful instrument to use? It has tungsten tips, and that makes it give out less heat. So the collateral thermal damage that happens because of a Colorado probe is much more less in quantum than a conventional tip. However, if you're a person who enjoys orbital surgery, I think you're looking at a radio frequency probe. Minimizes thermal damage to a very great extent and produces fantastic cutting capabilities in a very, very delicate manner. And the costly ones like Elman cost a bomb, but there are some beautiful radio frequency probes which are available, Indian made, which are as cheap as 25 to 30,000 rupees available in the market. And trust me, you'll start enjoying them not only for orbital surgery, but also gingival surgery. Okay. Now, radio frequency probes are fantastic for people who are interested in gingival plastic surgery. So it's a beautiful thing to have. The third one is globe and muscle protection. The globe protection has already been covered by Krishnan in the way of using conformers. While I would like to stress a very important point of muscle protection. Now, this is a common technique which we follow in our practice. I always tag my muscles, whether it is an inferior rectus or a medial rectus. There are two reasons for this. One, the muscle itself can be tagged and used as a traction suture so that the whole globe goes up and your cornea is never exposed in the field of surgery. This is one reason. Two, when you're going into deep orbital dissection, you always have the muscle in your hand which can be mobilized and seen, so that by mistake, when you're releasing a tethered muscle, somebody asked about secondary correction of muscle entrapment. When you have a tethered muscle and you're looking at releasing the muscle, this is a beautiful maneuver by which you can actually keep pulling on the muscle and seeing its continuity. Let us say by mistake, while de-tethering it, you are actually stripping it off. Immediately under GA itself, call for an oculoplastic surgeon if they are available, or a strabismologist who will actually do a primary anastomosis, which will make it much more convenient. You will still have remnants of the muscle there, which at a later point of time will become extremely difficult. So this is one reason why I would want all of you to get acquainted with muscle protection maneuvers. If you can't, of course, you have to be pretty careful while doing this. Don't take it very light, because high incidence of damage to the globe is there when you take a muscle stitch, unless you're trained for it. Okay, so but nevertheless, you can take along an ophthalmologist or oculoplastic surgeon who's comfortable in doing it and help you only with this for a few cases before you master it. The next set of tips is how to approach the deep orbit. Okay, now when you're looking at approach, choose the best approach that you are comfortable with. There is no hard and fast rule saying that if you're an orbital surgeon, you have to use only transconjunctival or only transcarunicular. No. You make a decision as what suits you the best. If it's a transcutaneous approach, please choose a transcutaneous approach, but do the best of surgeries. So how do you select the best approach that is useful for you? The role of the equator, let's understand what is the equator. Locating the confluence, most of us will understand theoretically what the confluence is. We will practically look at what is its importance. What is the role of doing an FDT after reconstruction? Krishnan already told that once you complete a zygoma surgery or an orbital surgery, make it a mandate to do an FDT on table so that you're able to demonstrate good movement. Your surgery might be good, your plate might look fantastic on the CTs, but if your muscle is not moving and part of your muscle is actually under the plate, then it's going to be a very, very embarrassing situation, and it might actually pose a lot of problems to correct at a later point of time. So do a mandatory FDT after reconstruction. And then the last one, if you are doing intraorbital surgery and you are scared that your vision is getting compromised, how will you check for it? Now, this is the most important point, according to me. How do you check intraoperatively for function of the optic nerve? Because we have already seen a lot of surgeons talk about this. When you're going inside and then suddenly the pupil starts getting dilated, what do you do? Do you abandon the procedure and come out? No, you don't. So I will give you some practical tips as to how to manage that or assess that intraoperatively and then make a good decision. Now, again, choosing a good approach, I, for one, believe transconjunctival incisions are good because like the maxillofacial surgeons that we are all excellently trained for intraoral approaches. Similarly, if you're an orbital surgeon, you should be trained for transconjunctival approaches. And this is a transcarunicular approach. You can see the medial rectus has already been tagged, and this is what we do to open. It's a retrocarunicular approach being demonstrated here. So first you make the conjunctival incision, flat dissection, reach the Muller's muscle, and then go along the plane of the Muller's muscle, and then you reach the plane of the medial orbital wall. Okay, part of it is done in a sharp fashion, and part of it is done as a teasing dissection. So that is how a medial approach with a transcarunicular is performed. The next one would be a transconch approach with a lateral cantalysis. This provides a much more extensive view of what we are looking at. It will usually help you expose almost 270 degrees of the orbit in terms of the floor, the medial wall, as well as the lateral walls. I'm sorry that I'm running it at two or three speed. The simple reason is I want you to understand that this is a predictable approach which can be done by all of us. At the same time, I don't want to waste time on it. For anybody who is interested, this video is already available on YouTube. You can go and check it up. So that is pretty much how a transconj is done. And for such an extensive procedure, as well as implants that are being placed, large size implants, these implants are close to about 4 centimeters in length and width. For them to be placed, that is the amount of scar you're left with once you finish the procedure. So that is what makes these intraorbital approaches or transconjunctival approaches that much more pleasing and tempting for us to try. Now, the next one is use of the equator. Let's understand what exactly is the equator. So that is the globe, and that is the midline from top to bottom. That is the equator. And the globe generally goes in about 25 millimeters. So please understand that. So the equatorial region is this, you know, anything under the equator is the equatorial region, and anything behind the equator is the retroequatorial region. Now, what is the significance clinically when you're looking at equatorial region and retroequatorial region? Any mesh that is put here, the first 15 millimeters or so, is not going to correct your in-ophthalmos. Please understand that equatorial reconstruction is only useful for hypoglobus correction, which means superior inferior corrections. Okay. And any retroequatorial reconstruction in this form, oblique form, is going to give you projection or enophthalmus correction. So this is the most important thing. And the safe distance, as what we talk, is generally in relation to the globe. So any retroglobar area is called unsafe because you're going nearer to the apex. But generally, any kind of good enophthalmus correction would require you to go between 25 and 38 millimeters of dissection. So that is where the critical decision of how to perform deep orbital dissection comes into play. So the next question is, now we need to go retro-equatorial and then perform deep orbital dissection. How and what do we use as markers during our deep orbital dissection? So deep orbit is nothing but the part which is beyond 25 millimeters to about 38 to 40 millimeters. That is what is called the deep orbit. And the basic markers for them, already Dr. Krishnan has told, the inferior orbital fissure is a very important marker that is seen through the course of the infraorbital nerve. As you go along the infraorbital nerve and groove and then trace it behind, it actually dips into the inferior orbital fissure at the posterior 1/3 to anterior 2/3 junction. From there on, you are in a critical position. From there on, you have to be very, very careful. Till then, you can do all your maverick maneuvers, but after that, you are going to be slightly more careful. So that is why the inferior orbital fissure is of extreme importance. The next is the greater wing of sphenoid, and we need to locate what is called as the sphenoid lip. The third one is the orbital process of the palatine bone, which forms the bulk of the hammer's key area or the medial bulge. And then the last one is the orbital confluence. Confluence is nothing but meeting of different things. So where the greater wing of sphenoid and the sphenoid lip meet the orbital process of the palatine bone is called the orbital confluence. Now let us look at these in detail. So this is this yellow thing here. Of course, it's got a bit of distorted. This is the infraorbital nerve, which I had marked. Actually, it has to go like this. Okay, that's the infraorbital groove. You can actually see it on the dry skull. And then this is the inferior orbital fissure, the whole thing here. I'm sorry of the distortion a bit. So this is the posterior 1/3. This is the anterior 2/3. And it goes and meets exactly here. This is approximately 25 millimeters. So this is what is called as the safe distance of the orbit for us to dissect, for most beginners to dissect. So that 25 millimeters comes like this. So anything behind by about 10 millimeters to 15 millimeters here is the unsafe distance that you have to traverse, and you have to be prepared for that. That is the greater wing of sphenoid, and that is the sphenoid lip. This is the orbital process of the palatine bone, and the place where these two things meet, where the inferior orbital fissure turns to form the superior orbital fissure, is called the orbital confluence. When you look at it clinically, this picture is actually matched to the one on the left side. So this is this is the orbital process. That is A, the orbital process. B, lip of sphenoid. This is the lip of sphenoid. C is the confluence. Of course, the O is missing. I don't want to show it to you there. And just as a recap, this is approximately about 38 millimeters from the infraorbital rim. Now, we all talked about how to do post-surgical confirmation, whether we are doing good surgery. Have we placed the implant properly on the posterior ledge? Have we released all the muscles around it? The method for us to confirm it is doing an FDT or a forced duction test. You want the duction test to be negative and not positive. There are two methods for us to do the duction. The most common one that we all follow, the OMFS method, is the rectus method, where we actually are supposed to hold the recti muscle and then move it along the plane of movement. So for the inferior rectus, we will hold the inferior rectus and then move it superior inferiorly to see whether it is released in toto. If you want to see the medial, you have to hold the medial rectus and then do a mediolateral kind of movement. Now the oculoplastic surgeons prefer what is called as a limbus method, where they hold the sclerocorneal junction. We all have to train ourselves for this because it's a very elegant way of determining movements in all planes with one single test. So it gives you all plane assessment and how do we perform. This is a small video to show how a rectus test is performed for force duction. So you hold the rectus and then you have to move it in a good range of motion in the superior inferior fashion. And how is the limbus test performed? I'm sorry about the. Okay, fine. So limbus test helps you perform it in all planes of movement, superior, inferior, as well as medial lateral. So we need to get ourselves trained for that also. Now, the last thing which is of much critical debate is optic nerve monitoring intraoperative. When you're actually operating and you suddenly feel that you're getting worried that the optic nerve is not reacting, this is what you need to look at. And the most important one is the RAPD, which is a clinical test, while EVP is evoked visual potential, which has been tried as a prototype in a lot of centers. Of course, it's not very creditable. However, it can be used along in your surgery if you have that as a gadget along with you. It uses the central response from the brain. But in RAPD, this is a clinical test which most of us can perform very easily. This can be used as a diagnostic measure to find out optic nerve injury or a clinical test intraoperatively to find out whether the optic nerve is functioning to its efficient fullness. Now, how do we perform a RAPD test? This has changed the rhythm a bit because I had some sequence here. However, let's look at things from the top. Okay, so these are the normal pupils, and when you shine a torch at the normal pupil, okay, you are getting direct reflex as well as consensual reflex positive. Okay, you shine the torch at the normal pupil, you get direct as well as consensual positive. When you shine the torch at a affected pupil, you will get paradoxical dilatation both on the affected side as well as the unaffected side. That is RAPD. Now, why is it called RAPD, swinging flashlight test? Because the flashlight is taken from normal to abnormal back to normal. So you can keep on repeating this to see whether the rhythm works, and you can justify the stand on 2-3 cycles. So remember that flashlight is tested on the unaffected pupil. Both sides show reflex, direct as well as consensual. If you shine it on the affected pupil, you get loss of pupillary reflex on both the affected side as well as the unaffected side, which is paradoxical in nature. Get back to the same side and then you get constriction. So that is why it's called as a swinging flashlight test. You swing the flashlight from affected to unaffected back to the affected. Unaffected to affected back to the unaffected. Okay, so that's how the swinging flashlight test is done. And this is what we primarily do during intraorbital monitoring. Let us say I'm dissecting the deep orbit and then I have post-traumatic midriasis or sometimes mild edema, which is causing a midriatic reaction intraoperatively. I don't abandon the procedure immediately saying there is pupillary dilatation. No, you have to dim your operating lights, keep a screen in between, and then take a torchlight, a nice torchlight, and then swing the torchlight from the unaffected to the affected sides, elicit an RAPD test, see if it is positive or negative. If it is positive, then you are looking at a transient optic nerve injury. You might have to abandon. If not, the reactivity is good. Don't worry about the minimal midriasis that you are developing intraoperatively. Just proceed and finish the procedure. Okay.
Anand, due to paucity of time and you being addressing most of the questions that have come up so far, yeah. I guess we continue and finish and have discussions at the end.
Sure. Okay. So the next thing is we understand recent advances in trauma. Let's just run through these. And the main ones I'm going to cover are anatomical implants. For the sake of you to understand, gone are the days when we were trimming and using titanium implants. Now, good titanium implants are available from Stryker, Synthes, KLS Martin, etc., which are already pre-contoured and then give you the exact anatomical delineation as what you want to use. So this is one. The second one is use of computer-assisted surgery. And these are the different steps that you see in computer-assisted surgery. You have image reformatting, you have data enhancement, surgical simulation, intraoperative guidance, as well as outcome assessment. So these are the different steps in which you can cover a computer-assisted surgery, not only for understanding the problem where you have it here, but also surgical simulation and intraoperative guidance. And you can review and see whether you've done the right job. So outcome assessment is also an important fact. Now, there was a question on patient-specific implants. When would you choose patient-specific implants? Wherever we have a chance to use stock implants, this is a STL file of a stock implant, which is commercially available. And you can see in this particular case, the defect is so large that the stock implant is not able to cover. I need covering till here because that is where the posterior ledge is. This is beyond the 36-38 millimeters. It's almost at 42-44. And in these kind of cases where the defect is so large or so complex that you do not have adequate support for the regular stock implant or your commercially available titanium implants to make do the job, then you're looking at planning for a PSI. Okay, so this is the actual PSI planned. This is the photograph of the same PSI, and this is the PSI in situ. Okay, you placed it intraorbitally, and that is the region of the posterior ledge. So you can see that the earlier placed orbital implant is actually sticking here because it's fallen down because of improper posterior protection or stability. So these are the indications for a PSI. Can you use PSIs? Yes. Is it commercially viable? No, at the point of time, it's very expensive. But is there a role for it? Definitely yes, in cases where you cannot use the normally commercially available titanium implants because of improper stability or reduced dimensions, then PSIs come in handy. The last one is use of intraoperative navigation. The concept of navigation is very similar to the GPS that we use in the cars. And it can be extrapolated to the same here. You have different sensors which you can use, and you have a small pointer in the hand which is used like the car, and then the car is seen on the map. The map is the CT scan. So wherever you place the pointer is being shown on the CT scan, which is like a map. That is the system in which intraoperative navigation works. And this is a step to planning of intraoperative navigation. As you can see, the plate has already been exported into the treatment plan. And you can see it in all dimensions, axial, coronal, as well as sagittal. And you can use the pointer and then touch and see whether you've reached it or not. So that is how intraoperative navigation actually looks. The yellow one is the planned reconstruction. The white one is the broken bones. And then you can see that the pointer is actually touching the posterior ledge. This is the pointer. It is seen on all the axes. So this is the coronal showing the medial bulge region, the meeting of the medial wall and the lateral wall, I mean the floor. This is the medial wall again on the axial section, and that is the posterior ledge on the sagittal section. So how does it look intraoperatively? This is how it looks intraoperatively. Please follow these two videos because they run synchronous. Whenever I move the pointer here intraorbitally, this pointer will move on the sagittal film and show you whether I'm on the posterior ledge or not. Can you see? I hope you're able to appreciate that. This is what is the role of intraoperative navigation. When I put the pointer inside on a bony ledge or on a place inside, it will exactly show which is the place on the screen. So that gives us a lot of predictability when we are handling large orbital reconstructions or secondary procedures. Okay, let's go through some interesting complications, maybe three or four, then we'll sum up the clinical scenarios. This is a case where a suboptimal implant has been placed and the defect is so large that the implant has fallen into the sinus. So this is, you get complications like this also. This is another interesting complication where you have the intraconal placement of the implant. The medial flange of the implant, though it is lying in the right place, if you see the place is right, but the dissection of the medial defect has not been done in totality, and the tissues have not been deherniated, and then the implant has just been placed inside in the right place, but it is actually intraconal and the medial rectus is actually stretched. That is the medial rectus. Okay, so you can have complications like this. This is a very scary complication where there is intraconal placement of implant touching the optic nerve. That is the optic nerve, that is the medial rectus, that is the lateral rectus, and this is the optic nerve. And another view, and the implant is actually touching the optic nerve. This patient, we decided not to take him in for a redo procedure. He was referred to us, but we were also very worried to take him because any additions from the optic nerve to the implant and the secondary procedure to actually take off the additions might cause irreparable damage to the optic nerve. So we had to send him back without doing anything, but explaining to him that what he has got is a lucky break. This last one, of course, is an unfortunate incident where somebody's placed an implant from earth to sky, and there is actually a complete transection of the optic nerve. This is the optic nerve and that's the implant. which has gone through and through and then cut the optic nerve off. So this is the residual optic nerve, and that's the implant which has got placed. So please remember one thing. The orbit is a small place. It's a tricky place. And it looks very elegant and glamorous. But be careful that you've understood the basics of orbital surgery. Because the orientation for you to do intra-orbital surgery is extremely different from what we do outside. It is very similar to doing an intra-oral sagittal split osteotomy and then doing an extra-oral fracture reduction. You know, the orientation is totally different. I think you need to all train yourselves for intra-orbital surgery before you get into doing some major work. Now, let's go through some interesting case scenarios before we fold for the day as the presentations, and then we'll take up some residual questions. We will start with, we'll go in a sequence. This is a classical white eye blowout which requires immediate intervention. Okay, now you have a CT demonstrated white eye blowout. As you can see, there are no clinical symptoms, but when you check for extraocular motility, this is how you need to record in all 9 cases. And you can actually demonstrate that there is significant supero-inferior restriction, okay, as can be seen here. So this is an emergency and needs immediate surgery, and that is restitution of mobility within 3 days after the surgery. And this is how you need to maintain records. This is diplopia charting primary, and then this is diplopia charting post-surgical. Next, we will see what is called as, we finished immediate intervention. Let's see an indication for late primary, which means within the first 2 weeks. This person, if you notice from the frontal, I don't know if many of you can appreciate, has significant primary enophthalmus. You can see that this globe is almost protruding in relation to this one. So when you look at from the worm's eye view, that is the difference that you have. It's almost 8 millimeters of retropositioning. And this is classically a indication for early intervention, wherein you have demonstrable primary enophthalmus, and this is the correction. So with orbital reconstruction done at the right time, the outcomes are that much better. Then you have what is secondary correction. Somebody raised the question of entrapment of muscles and secondary correction. This is one such case where the medial rectus was entrapped and the patient had not only enophthalmus, but also exotropia, which means outward facing pupil. So you can see that this is central gaze and then this is an exotropic gaze because of entrapped medial rectus. And this one was done 8 months post injury with successful results. So this is correction of his fullness and enophthalmus. You can actually appreciate that the pupils are straightening up while compared to the other side. And this is his worm's eye view, showing excellent correction of enophthalmus as well as his exotropic gaze. This is an impure blowout which has been provided by Dr. Krishnan. Now, for people who don't understand what an impure blowout is or a pure blowout is, any intraorbital fracture, which means floor, medial wall, lateral wall, or roof, which does not associate itself with any fracture of the rim or associated facial bones outside, is called a pure blowout. And any fracture which involves part of the rim or associated facial bones is called a impure blowout. So in this case, this is a case of zygomatic orbital fracture, which has been reconstructed very well with ORIF of the zygoma and intraorbital mesh placement. You can see good degree of symmetry on both the sides. You can see restitution of the sinusoidal shape here. You can see the sinusoidal shape here and the mesh resting well on the posterior ledge. This is the 3D scan of the same patient, a comminuted zygoma with an orbit, and you can see that the zygoma has been very well adapted and fixed in position followed by the orbital reconstruction. The next thing you need to remember is whenever you have a facial bone fracture involving the rims and the orbit, please remember that the rims have to be fixed first and then only go internally. Otherwise, you will lose your orientation to fix the intraorbital implant. So always the rims have to be put in the right place. The zygoma has to be reconstructed. The infraorbital rim has to be reconstructed. The lateral orbital rim has to be reconstructed. And then only you go inside and then put the mesh so that you have the right orientation. Delayed primary correction because of retrobulbar hemorrhage. We've already seen this case. I've shown you the CT and this is the clinical presentation. This was the clinical presentation when the patient came to us. And then this is after correction. And this was the status. This is a comminuted flattening of the zygoma with retrobulbar hemorrhage. That is after reconstruction. You can see fantastic symmetry both at the arch as well as the frontal projection of the zygomatic prominence or malar prominence. This is the intraorbital part. This is the huge defect which is seen. This is a Jacquerie 4 defect, and it has been optimally reconstructed with a titanium mesh with complete deherniation of all the intraorbital contents. You can see the inferior rectus here, which is bloated up actually, inflamed and enlarged. And then you can see the nice thin form of the inferior rectus here. I'm sorry, I'm showing it to you on a bony window and not a soft tissue window. And this again is the complete deherniation. You have to take up all the contents, make sure you can actually see a shadow of the inferior rectus here. That's the optic nerve. And then beautiful resting of the sinusoidal implant on the posterior ledge here. So that is the sagittal scheme. And then this is the 3D reconstruction showing the reconstruction of the zygoma and the arch to near symmetry. This is a primary case, which is 6 days old, orbital apex syndrome. This patient again we saw, and this was one of these rare cases where we decided to do a primary decompression, navigation assisted. So we did a complete decompression of the orbit through a lateral approach, got the greater wing of sphenoid out, reduced the skull base fracture. And then this is the patient after about a week's time, where he's got almost proper restitution of all his neurological symptoms, but the vision was not completely normal. However, it improved a dramatic amount. And now after, this is almost 14 months after we've operated him, now he is near normal vision. So this is one of the rare instances where we have done a primary decompression for a neurological symptom. Not always do we do it. This we felt we could improve because he landed up on time. And then when we tried it, it gave us good symptomatic relief. This is the CT, which shows a gross comminution of the zygoma and restitution here with zygomatic reconstruction as well as floor, and a 3D CT basal view, which is showing the outcomes. Good correction of ENOF and orbital dystopia. This again is decompression of the optic canal, reorientation of the superior orbital fissure. Now this case, again, we saw, I'll show you how not managing a case also improves symptoms. Complete full-blown symptoms of superior orbital fissure syndrome. This is him after 8 months. Almost good in every gaze except the superior gaze. The reason was after 8 months, we redid a scan and then we found out that this inferior rectus has fibrosis to the floor. So here we will be forced to do a redo procedure. We were not able to complete it because of the COVID lockdown. He's waiting for the last 3.5 months. Hopefully in the next few months to come, we will release the inferior rectus. So just try to understand, not everything needs intervention. Sometimes neurological symptoms come back on their own. Thanks a lot. I know it's an exhaustive presentation, and you've all been kind enough with patient listening. And we'll try to take as many questions as possible now.
Kannan, thank you very much for a very lucid, descriptive, with videos presentation. I'm sure the delegates have enriched their knowledge on the orbital trauma and particularly the most advanced scenarios that you have explained. With this, though, we are probably nearing lunchtime, and so we just keep it very short. A few questions that probably have come by. To start with, one, since you are an exponent of transconjunctival approach, is there any specific way that I think probably you addressed, but then just to take it from the questions, a retroseptal or a preseptal, what would you prefer is one of the questions. And we'll take that first.
Okay, when you're looking at transconjunctival and preseptal versus retroseptal, the retroseptal version is the easiest to go. Especially when you have an intact or infraorbital rim. The decision which you need to use is the infraorbital rim intact or not? If there is an intact infraorbital rim and there is isolated orbital floor or medial wall, then a retroseptal approach is a direct approach. It's the easiest that you can use. If you have a fracture of the infraorbital rim with comminution, then you can't do a retroseptal predictably. Then you might have to do a preseptal, trace the plane under the conjunctiva, go there, expose it, and then see it. So my advice to most people when you're practicing your transconjunctival is intact infraorbital rim, go ahead and do a retroseptal, which is the most direct approach. In 30 seconds, you'll be in the orbital floor. if it is a comminuted rim, do not go retroseptal because you will land up into the sinus knowing not where to go. Use a preseptal approach.
Dr. Anand, would it also be safe to presume that retroseptal approach would be better when you are doing a transcarotid thing because otherwise you would end up injuring your lacrimal artery?
Yeah, when you're doing a transcarotid, you have to be more careful. A retrocarotid is much easier, like what Dr. Krishnan said now. I also prefer the retrocarotid approach, and both transcarotid as well as retrocarotid can actually be combined with a transconjunctival approach in producing a very good exposure, extended approach. However, a retro is always safer when it comes to transcarotid. Retrocarotid.
There's one question that is, is there any role for transphenoidal, transethmoidal, transantral approaches to the orbit?
Transsphenoidal approach and transethmoidal are most commonly used for negotiating foreign bodies and relieving compression symptoms. These are the most common reasons for which you do transphenoidal and transethmoidal approaches. Of course, they are FES approaches. And the transantral approach is something which has recently picked up because it gives a very good idea about where you are placing the implant in relation to the posterior ledge. However, I do not have much of experience. The moderator himself is quite experienced in that technique. He uses his unit uses a lot of transantral approach for verification of implant placement. And I think Vivek, you should maybe add a few points on that.
Yeah, because this question came by also, so I thought I will ask you. Yes, endoscopy definitely plays a very important role. If you have a good person to have in your team who's experienced with endoscopes, I think there is a big scope, especially the posterior aspect, especially if there are spurs of bony spicules, which are very close to the optic foramen and things like that. To pick up those things, it definitely plays a very important role, Anand.
Thank you. Thank you. I think most of you should take a leaf from this. Nothing wrong in taking help from our colleagues and even learning the art. You know, endoscopy, sticking a scope actually has a lot of benefits.
Kannan, if you have any more questions, please.
No, I think that's comprehensively summed up. I think a couple of last minute questions just to take them up. If all the walls are comminuted, especially the medial wall, is there any trick or technique you want to say before you go ahead and reconstructing the medial aspect? All the rims, the question was, the medial rim is also comminuted.
How would you prefer
fixation?
I think what Dr. Anand said was reconstructing the outer orbital frame is the key. Get your outer orbital frame right and then go.
That's the question, Krishnan. That's the question. If it's comminuted, how are you going to? Is there any trick or technique you want to give?
Yeah, so probably maybe, I mean, I'm just speaking offhand. Maybe Dr. Anand has more experience in this. Probably this might be a situation where you can do a mirroring of the orbits, get your 3D models printed, and pre adapt the plates onto them. So, usually, what as maxillofacial surgeons we do, we try to adapt the plates to the fracture. This might be a situation where you would want to adapt the fracture to the pre-adapted plate, you know. So you are reasonably confident that you are getting the bones in probably the right kind of place. But comminuted fractures are definitely a challenge.
Actually, this seems to be a question from somebody who has done work and then got stuck, you know, because this needs a lot of experience. It's not a common situation. However, one good important point that you need to understand is if you have comminuted three rim fractures, like what was asked, please do a coronal exposure. No minimal exposures. Please do a coronal exposure. I would always like to have pre-adapted plates when I'm handling rims. Like what Dr. Krishnan said, this is a fantastic case for mirroring and then pre-adapting plates. However, the exposure needs to be grand. There is no minimal exposure in this. Do a coronal approach. Open the whole upper part of the face and then start from lateral because that is a more dependable area. Even if you're not able to reconstruct the medial rim, do not worry. Because generally the orbital reconstruction follows the floor to medial concept. The medial is the last one that you need to worry about. It's actually floor to medial concept. So if you're able to reconstruct the lateral rim and the infraorbital rim well, and then put a bridging bone in the medial aspect, get a reasonable stability on the medial aspect, you still can reconstruct the floor. The floor will give you a good idea as to where the medial wall has to be. Okay, so that's the key. Do not attempt the medial first. It's always lateral to medial because from the stronger buttresses to the weaker buttresses and mirroring and STL model pre-adaption of plate, yes, is a major role. Make sure your approach is grand.
Yeah, no, I agree. So probably use bone grafts also. If you have a grand approach, you're going to have a graft and probably a pre-adapted plate. That's
right. Yes. And then there's one question which has come by now. Some light on how to reconstruct the orbital roof. We have been talking about the floor, the medial wall, and now when there's a roof involvement, is there a, how do you go about it?
Okay. Now, roof is a very very less dealt with topic again. Now, first, let us see what is the classification of roof fractures, okay, to start with. Roof can be classified as blow-in fractures, blow-out fractures, roof with supraorbital rim fractures, as well as frontobasilar type fractures. This is how roofs are classified. Now, when you are looking at when to reconstruct the roof, is there a role for reconstruction of the roof? Yes, when you have a blow-in fracture of the roof is when you are going to be more worried. Because the fragments are going to blow out of the roof is when you're going to be blow in is when you have the roof collapsing inside and then causing limitation of movements. Okay, the brain has does not have much of a problem. It will actually follow if there is no dural tear. If there are no dural tears, the brain will actually herniate into the place. Okay, it does not have a problem, but it is the orbit which is going to suffer at the cost. It's going to form secondary healing underneath, and then the ocular motility is going to be disturbed because of a blow-in roof. So when you have a blow-in roof and you're going to feel that there are impingement on the muscles and it is going to produce ocular motility problems, go ahead and then reconstruct the roof. If you have a blowout, if there is intact dura, intact bony ledges, and there is no discrepancy, there are no CSF leakage issues or brain herniations, frank issues, then you don't have to worry about it. Otherwise, frontobasilar types, again, for stability as well as structural integrity, you might want to reconstruct it with large meshes. Otherwise, by far, very less interventions for roof.
Anand, a couple of questions addressed directly with your name. In a large defect, would you go in for later because there's an extensive orbital defect, either floor or medial wall? There's no specific question there and it's addressed to you. Would you allow fibrosis and how would you manage them later?
No, in any case of orbital fracture, late presentation, early presentation, the best time, especially when a large defect is there, is the earliest. There is no scope for waiting for it and then doing it. At least because it's addressed directly to me, I would say, even if there is a large defect, I would go in and do it as early as possible rather than wait for it. Because outcomes have always been shown that the more amount of delay there is, the more problems there are with normal restitution as well as fat atrophy.
And I think the people who are starting out the orbital surgery should also specifically explain to patients the risks of orbital surgery, because I myself have had one or two patients who are not willing to even accept the theoretical risk of a possible vision loss and said that they are not interested in orbital reconstruction and they can live with an anophthalmos, but they cannot accept the possible vision loss. So I think patient consultations also have to be taken and given importance.
Krishna Ranant, a couple of more questions which came earlier. Mm-hmm. How do you manage a late entropion?
Entropion? Mm. Okay. See, entropion and ectropion are basically problems that are associated with what you call as lamellae, okay? You have the outer lamellae and the inner lamellae. The outer lamellae is essentially the skin and the tarsal plate. The inner lamellae is the conjunctiva. So when you have the attachments of the skin to the tarsal plate or the conjunctiva, the palpable conjunctiva, the tarsal plate is when you have situations of entropion or ectropion. And both have to be reconstructed radically with generally interposition materials. Just a release will not solve it. You normally need grafting or interposition reconstruction when you're handling delayed entropions or ectropions.
The difference between me and Anand is I would have said refer to the ophthalmologist.
Oculoplastic, Krishnan, not ophthalmology. It will come back to you.
Like saying go to an endodontist to get your third molars removed.
No, is there any role for mannitol in reducing intraorbital pressure? This is from a good friend of yours, Anand. So
yes, there is. When you're looking at compartment syndromes, like I said earlier, always there is a role for not only carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, but also for diuretics, because the mechanism is very similar to managing acute trauma to the brain. The schedule for management is almost very similar. So I would definitely say yes. there is a big role for both acetazolamide and mannitol.
There's a couple of theoretical questions. Is there any zones of the orbit like you do subunits of the phase? Is there any subunits of the orbit? That is one.
Actually, and two, what there was sorry, Kanan, finish, please.
No. Subunits of the orbit, and is there any classification for pure fractures?
Okay. Now, I saw in the question answer session that somebody was asking about a reference for Beathammer's key area.
Yeah.
Actually, there is a very interesting article which was published by Zachary and Hammer on classification of internal orbital fractures from their series of about 72 cases or so. And they have beautifully classified zone 1, zone 2, okay. zone 3. The anterior one-third, the middle one-third, and the posterior one-third for orbital reconstructions. And a big amount of relevance has been given to what is called as the medial strut of the inferior orbital fissure. The inferior orbital fissure has a medial strut. So their classification essentially revolves around the integrity of the inferior medial strut, as well as which zone it occupies, the anterior one-third, the middle one-third, or the posterior one-third. Now, this is one of the most comprehensive classifications that can be provided for internal orbital fracture reconstruction. Not only does it classify the fracture, but it also gives beautiful directives on how to manage each of the fractures. And another good set of articles has been published from Amsterdam by Dubois and Becking, where they have done a series of systematic reviews and meta-analysis where they have defined how to make your fracture reconstruction approach based on Zachary and Hammer's classification. Now, the same article will have details on Hammer's key area, as well as the AOCMF manual has a beautiful chapter. The older manual has a beautiful chapter on orbital fractures by Beathammer himself, where he has lucidly explained the concept.
Ananta, I have a couple of questions which are coming by. One is, what is the role of bone grafts, autogenous bone grafts in reconstruction?
Okay.
We've been addressing only on mesh.
Correct. So what is the role of autogenous bone grafts or autogenous materials on reconstruction? Again, let's go back to Zachary's classification because it's a beautiful one. When you're looking at a type 1 or a type 2 fracture, if most of you are hooked onto the internet, you can immediately look up for that picture. I don't know whether, let me see if I have it. You look up in the picture, there is actually type 1, type 2, type 3, and type 4. Type 3 and type 4 are those which do not have structural integrity, where the inferomedial strut is broken, and then you have to reconstruct the posterior medial bulge. Now, let's all understand one thing. Most autogenous materials cannot produce the sinusoidal shape that we need. So when you have large fractures where the type 2, 3 and type 4 ones, where you need that sinusoidal shape to be reconstructed as well as the structural integrity of the inframedial strut to be re-established, then it is always better that you choose alloplastic materials like titanium mesh, which can actually be molded and kept. In other fractures, the bone grafts can comfortably be used. However, to put a note on this, before the advent of anatomical meshes, what they used to do is they used to push a mesh in the bottom and then use incremental bone grafts in the posterior medial area. Hammer himself has advocated this technique only. He will put a baseline mesh and then in the inferomedial and the posterior medial part, just to get the bulge, what he will do is he will sequentially cut smaller pieces of bone and keep on stacking it there so that the posterior medial area alone is elevated. So this can also be followed.
Another
but
question
I think
is,
it's also important to remember that when we were students, probably titanium meshes were more experimental and extremely expensive. But now with meshes being very reasonably priced and easily available in India, I think that's a better option for the orbit and contours than bone grafts.
Any thing on the fate of the ligaments of the orbit?
Vivek, before you address the question, can I just add one small thing for this? With the meshes which have come in, the concept of orbital compartment syndrome has disappeared.
Yes.
Earlier when we are reading, we used to give more for retrobulbar hemorrhage or when you're stacking up big blocks of grafts, not the small ones like Anant was saying, you don't know where you're going. Now mesh is very thin, very predictable, reasonably predictable, unless otherwise you are putting it vertically like Anant showed. Whatever you do, you are a bit more easier with the optic nerve, however far back you go. Now identifying the ledge and placing it is a bit more comforting than putting up a big block of bone and adding on top of it. So That is why people tend to prefer meshes. And being perforated, all the bleeding comes out.
Yeah. And there's a natural drainage into the sinus.
Yeah, sinus, that's all. So nothing stays inside. Sorry, go on, Vivek.
Yeah, no, there's one more question which came by. What is the fate of the ligaments in the orbit, Anant?
Krishnan? Ligaments in the orbit. Krishnan, you want to handle that?
God knows.
Okay. When you're looking at ligaments, there are only two things that you need to understand. One is the medial one, and then the one on the lateral side. Essentially, they are suspensory ligaments. Once the suspensory ligaments are in place, generally the globe has good support, okay, unless the septum is torn. So that is the clinical relevance. However, when you're looking at ligaments of attachment, you need to look at associated fractures. The medial component of the ligaments get detached when you have a NOE fracture, and the lateral part of the ligaments get detached when you have a zygomatic complex fracture. So if they are displaced, then replace them in the right position by bony apposition or reconstruction. If they are detached, reattach them. You have to do a PEXI. So you either do a medial canthopexy or a lateral canthopexy and then get the ligaments in position.
So I had mentioned this transosseous insertion of the lateral canthal tendon, but one of my ophthalmology colleagues said that if you are struggling to do a transosseous lateral canthal tendon position, just pull the tarsus as close as possible and suture it, because that itself would give you a decent amount of shape, you know, if you are not sure what you are suturing.
Correct. It is called lateral tarsal strip excision and PEXI, plication. So that also can be done. Yeah. It's something like when you have I'm sorry, I'm not able to get the term right away. Yeah, but it is a very good thing. You just take the end of the tarsal plate, clip it off, and then do a plication procedure, which will actually make the lower eyelid more taut, you know, and in position. But if it is detached, it is always better, like what Dr. Krishnan says, to do a transosseous fixation. That will help much better.
Okay. Instead of bone grafts, Anantu, what is your experience using titanium pellets to stack up the back?
Okay. Titanium pellets. Now, this is cutting edge research. Okay. Recently, there are two papers from Dusseldorf, actually from Majid Rana, who is considered to be an exponent on using customized titanium pellets. Now, what they are doing is, instead of invasive huge implants, they are predicting the amount of volume loss by doing what is called as multiple image fusion analysis, and then trying to find out where exactly the volume loss is and generating multiple small pellets to increase volumes in that particular regions. This is cutting edge technology, which we don't have in India as of now. However, for PG's sake, what Dr. Kannan is referring to is a material of using patient-specific titanium pellets, which is published and spoken of much by the people from Dusseldorf.
Thanks, Anand.
Kannan, I think we should, anything more, or we can...
This is just one final clinical one. So, Anand, if there is an oculocardiac reflex occurring on table when you're reconstructing, would you think of giving a local there or trying to deepen the anesthesia? Like your LA, which you said to correct your this thing in an awake patient to delay surgery, would you do it intra-op also to gain control over?
Yes, actually, oculocardiac reflex is a much spoken concept in orbital as well as zygomatic surgeries. But frankly speaking, I have been operating orbits since 2006, and I have only landed up with two cases of oculocardiac reflex, only twice. One was a very benign one where nothing mattered, only once it came, and second time it went off. And the other one was a recent episode about 4 months back when I had recurrent episodes for the same patient whenever I was touching the inferior rectus to relieve it of an adhesion. Okay, and my anesthetist said very calmly that we don't need to deepen the anesthesia, just give local infiltration. And lo and behold, it worked fantastically. After two rounds of infiltration, there was absolutely no problem. And trust me, one more thing, the moment I released the inferior rectus, how much ever you hold and pull the inferior rectus, it was not getting elicited. The tethered inferior rectus was producing a vagal response, but the released inferior rectus was not. I don't have an explanation for that, however, but this is how we managed. We gave a local infiltration twice, and it was managed successfully. We were able to complete the procedure.
Okay, thank you. Two are open. Do you want to finish?
Finish it up. Okay.
Yeah,
I thought it was not really relevant here. Anyway, what is growing skull fracture is one of the questions which is open. I didn't answer it. Yeah.
Okay. Krishnan, do you want to take that?
I have no idea.
Okay. Growing skull fracture comes in pediatric age groups for the orbital roof. Okay. When you have a fracture of the orbital roof, which has not been addressed, well, what happens is because of the rapid growth potential of the child, the roof fracture splays apart and then produces what is called as a leptomeningeal herniation, where the brain actually goes down into the orbit. So it is a nasty secondary deformity and has to be reconstructed in conjunction with a neurosurgeon. It has to be done transcranial, not through the orbital approach. It has to be done transcranial. And it is a formal neurosurgical procedure. Most of the leptomeningeal herniations, if you see, are reported more in neurosurgical literature and less in oculoplasty or maxillofacial literature.
Yeah, don't want to leave one more question which is open. Yeah. Reference articles for reconstructive material of the orbit. Anand, you can share it somewhere.
No, it is there. 2014-15, Dubois, Leander Dubois. So three articles are there. When to intervene, what to do, and how to do. Beautiful systematic reviews available on the net.
So I think we've answered most of the questions. Dr. Reena and Dr. Jimson,
can I bring you? Thanks. Thank you, everyone. I think we have covered everything, whatever has asked. Jimson, there was a question asking if there is, where can we find the YouTube link later? So that is addressed to you. So either you want to post it or send it. So now we have truly completed all questions, Vivek.
Yeah, okay.
Special mention of thanks to all of you because this was very vibrant, not only because of things that were organized, but also because of the moderators. You know, you need very vibrant and dynamic moderators to keep the session lively. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I hope the audience also did the same. Pardon us for the time.
No, I think, overshot by probably about half an hour, maybe 1 o'clock lunchtime. We see some people leaving. Yeah, right. It's understandable. So anyway, I should at this juncture on my own behalf, thank Krishnan and Anand for a wonderful session and presentation. And thank you, Company Stryker, for organizing this wonderful program and this forum to help the delegates during this lockdown. And thank you, Dr. Reena and Jimson from my end.
I would also like to thank everybody. And it's been very humbling to see Dr. Anand's presentation. And Dr. Anand's presentation is sort of a objective way of us knowing how much far we still have to go to reach what he has achieved. So congrats, Anand. And
Krishnan, thanks a lot. It was a great teamwork. And Reena ma'am and Jimson, thanks for the initiative. The fabulous platform for us to actually... be of help. And I hope that whoever has attended has carried back good information which is of clinical use. I think that's the whole secret for which we are all trying for. And it's a great initiative, ma'am and Jimson.
Thank you. Thank you, Anand, Krishnan, Dr. Vivek and Kandan for the fantastic session. I've already started getting fantastic feedback on my WhatsApp and in the feedback that I've already seen. And to answer Kandan's question, where we will find this recording, it is available in our MaxFax Talk YouTube channel, and also it will be linked to the MaxFax Talk website as well. So all the presentations will be made available. Yeah. Thank you all for participating, and hope to see you all again next Sunday, 11 o'clock for the next session on trauma. And not to forget that there is a session again tomorrow evening, 8 o'clock on Ask Your Mentor session. Tomorrow it's going to be Dr. Josh Paul and Dr. Muthushekar, moderated by Dr. Balagogan. And one more request that this evening there is another session by the National Association. It is going to be a student presentation. There are, I think, 10 presentations by the I mean, the price paper category from Midcoms. Kannan, you would like to add anything on that?
No, I think, yeah, no, because Midcoms is not happening now. We have to, at least we thought these people might finish off before next Midcoms. So the idea is to have an online price paper category and we can participate. The judges are there, they will be evaluating, but we can be audience, like we sit in a price paper participation. I think it is important. So it'll be 8-minute presentation with 2 minutes for questions. So whoever is free, it'll be great if you can log in.
It'll be like encouraging the postgraduates itself.
And also, we will know how to proceed in future also. We can have more such. So we don't know with this situation, if it's dragging, this is another way to.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. See you next week then.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thanks for
joining us. Thank you all.
Thank you, Striker. Mayank.
Yeah, more important. Yeah.
Andrew.
Striker and Reena.
Reena
madam has just logged out. Yeah.
Thanks to Mayank, Chandru, and
thank you. Thank you so much, sir. It's been a good opportunity, sir.
Yes. Again, final thanks to the speakers, Krishnan and Anand.
Hey,
and
thank you. Vivek, I forgot to thank Kannan. Hey, Kannan, thank you so much. So,
see what all I have to do to get a thanks out of you.
Hey man.
Never mind. Just
I thought we were in the same boat, man. So I didn't thank
no,
you.
Just kidding, Vivek. Thank you. No, I know. It's
Shall we leave?
Yes. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. Bye. Yeah. Bye. Yeah. Bye. Bye.
To lose an opportunity to pull your leg. So bye everyone.